You want to get this thing going?
Yeah, let me just start the tape and slate it. So we'll hear a crack here in a second.
Okay, and I'll essentially, you know, do the intro and we'll be off to the races.
Right on. I'm set on my end.
All right. Check. 1, 2. Check. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to a very special interview episode of Media Monarchy. My name is James Evan Pilato, and I am your host and webmaster of the show and website, MediaMonarchy.com. And I'm so happy today to have the guest on the line that we have for you. He's someone who, for me, has been a big inspiration for MediaMonarchy.com. That's the simplest way I can put it. His name is Richard Andrew Grove. He's currently the editor-in-chief of Tragedy and Hope magazine, and that's at tragedyandhope.com. But prior to this current project, Richard invested over 6 years reading over 600 books to better understand our non-elected rulers. And before that, Richard was a corporate whistleblower, bringing to light more than 3 years ago that companies like AIG were defrauding investors. Does that sound familiar? But lastly, way back at the beginning, Richard worked on the 98th floor of the North Tower at the World Trade Center and was present on the morning of 9/11 to witness the events. So his odyssey of discovery spans the last 8 years, ever since he had the misfortune to learn that the world he occupied was, in truth, unlike anything we had ever been taught about. So Richard's journey gives us, I think, something really special, because Richard's not here just to hear himself talk, and neither am I. We're here to try and cut a critical line of thought directly through the maze and leave you guys with all the tools you need to see 9/11 and our world for what it is. And when we see that, we'll all be better prepared to take constructive action and elevate the game. Richard Grove, welcome to MediaMonarchy.com.
James, it's my pleasure. I'm excited to be here and a longtime listener of your excellent podcast. Great work, buddy.
Thanks so much, man. So it's it's September 10th, 2009. I'm in Portland, Oregon, and you are on the other side of the country. What, put quite simply, brought the two of us together to be talking about, still talking about, the events of 9/11 when so many people seem to just want to put it aside?
Well, I mean, from my perspective, I'm still learning about what happened that day in addition to the history behind the things that made the events happen that day. And when I got into producing media, I started out with a piece called Project Constellation, which was like a 2-hour MP3 explaining the whistleblowing that I did and what I've discovered through that. And it was basically to hand over these facts to people who I felt were responsible researchers and responsible, you know, talk show hosts, and to say, look, here's all these things that tie into this 9/11 problem that you guys are talking about, but no one's mentioning these key facts, these key figures, these key corporations. So it was more my trying to throw the message over the wall and expecting somebody else to do something with it. And what I learned from putting that recording out was that the people that I had idolized as, you know, truthers or truth leaders or the godfathers of the truth movement had no interest in looking into these corporations or these personalities, characters behind the different entities that were perpetrating and profiting from 9/11. So in going through that experience, it's like, all right, I need to get this information out in a more coherent way. And I created the podcast, which was 9/11 Synchronicity. And you may have heard that at one point, but it was kind of an odyssey and a journey that takes people through the stream of consciousness. And what I was looking for out of that was to inspire other people to create their own media, to do their own research, and to bring original ideas and new research and connections out to the public. And I got to a point where I was like, it's really irresponsible of me to continue leading people on until I do a lot more homework and really broaden my horizons and get some real answers, because I wasn't interested in using fear to propagate the information I knew that people needed and they wanted, and that they're unwitting to all these scams. But I needed to lose the fear myself. I needed to lose that panic that comes from not understanding. And that's where I kind of started to sit back and say, look, maybe everything I was taught, maybe all my education, left out a couple convenient facts. And in those pieces of blind spot, those voids, there could be something there that's, you know, invisibly controlling us. And that's where you get into, you know, research on our non-elected leaders.
So I first became familiar with you when I heard Project Constellation by way of Maria Heller of the Maria Heller Show, and that's MERIA.net. She was, I believe, the first person to play what I kind of refer to Project Constellation in a way as a sort of message in a bottle, that you're putting it out there and hoping that good, responsible people will get it and spread it to the world. Maria Heller was the first to do that, and in a way, seemingly one of the few and only to get your story out. I first heard Project Constellation, and it gave me a lot to think about. So when you then followed it up a few months later with starting the 9/11 Synchronicity podcast, I don't know if you were being tongue-in-cheek there, I listened to every episode of 9/11 Synchronicity, and it's that really made me want to start the radio show of Media Monarchy. I had started the website, appropriately enough, the first posting is September 11th, 2005, is when I started MediaMonarchy.com. It wasn't until just over a year later that I began the radio show here at the Portland Radio Authority. Your show was, in a way, I think, the inspiration, and that's what you're talking about, and it almost has a sort of DIY kind of punk ethic of showing you, in a way, that I think this is a book, our band could be your life, that this is something that you can do yourself. With the media, the tools are available, and it was someone like you who was always very well-spoken and made so much sense and wasn't there really pushing an agenda or a product or fear. It was a newer, smarter, more kind of coherent and cogent way to look at things and do some research. So both those things were a huge inspiration to me. So again, I just like having you here on the line right now to say thank you.
Well, you're very welcome, and I'm really proud of the fact that you were one of the people that took the initiative that I kind of put out there. And I said at the end of Project Constellation, there needs to be an independent media organization, a network that brings the best of these different authors and academics and activists and filmmakers all together into one place. And because none of us can do it alone, and none of us can cover all these facts by ourselves, and none of us have all of the answers, but together, we all know what's going on, and we just need to drop our egos and say, look, we have a couple things that we agree on, and one of those things is that tomorrow we can do a better job than we've been doing today, and that things can definitely be better than the way they've been given to us in the status quo. The status quo does not empower us. So I think it benefits all of us to ask credible questions and do your own homework and find answers and share them with each other. So that's what the current Project Tragedy and Hope is all about. But, you know, to take a step back into what actually got me out of, you know, the sheepleness. I mean, when I worked in corporations, I basically had been trained and conditioned the whole life, you know, when I was growing up, going through school, get good grades, be an honest person. And so you go out in the world and you do that. And to get the things you want, you need to go earn some money. So I got into a profession that was very lucrative, and the clients that I had were the largest financial institutions in the world. So it's like when you find out that the world's not exactly how they taught you it was, and you have to do these lessons, it's like you can continue with the money, but you have to give up this thing that you consider yourself. You have to give up your integrity. You have to give up your credibility and do things that they want you to do for money. And that's what money's for. It's to make people do things that they wouldn't do otherwise out of the goodness of their heart, right? So that was a real, I don't know, it was a real gut check to have to be able to say, what's more important, you know, having some integrity and being broke or having a bunch of money and thinking that you're happy because somebody sold you that idea of happiness?
This reminds me of something I believe you've referenced before, and that's the story of the Oliver Stone film Wall Street. And when you jump into the tank with Gordon Gekko.
Yeah, I mean, on numerous occasions, I found, and I had watched that movie a lot growing up, and I kind of, you know, idolized the guys who work on Wall Street and make all this money because they're brokers and they can basically do as they please in the world, right? But then working as a software sales rep, inside of these large financial institutions and learning what they're doing with this software, learning that they're investing $200 million on a project to steal billions of dollars of your money, I didn't think that was cool. And nothing I had ever learned in college prepared me for that experience. So, you know, it was a slap in the face. And yeah, I kind of felt like Charlie Sheen in Wall Street, because it's like, wow, you know, making money is cool, but it doesn't make me sleep well at night. It doesn't make me healthy. It doesn't really win me any useful friends. And, you know, it didn't resonate with my heart. So I did what I did.
Which
I'm thankful for it.
Well, and I think that's basically bringing us to the point that money can't always be used to make you happy or to make you shut up. So I think what we want to do, as we're talking about 9/11 and we're the day before the 8th anniversary, this is a large subject that, again, I think scares away many people, because when they look into this conspiracy theory world and culture, they see a big, ugly mess of debunkers and agents and agendas and leaders and distractions, and ultimately they say, you guys are all pretty nuts. I always want to make sure that this material is accessible to people and that it doesn't scare people away. And that's what I've always tried to strive to do with the show, is, you know, try and always do a better job and make it accessible to folks that they want to look further into the information. So money can't buy happiness, nor can it always buy silence. So let's start by speaking about someone named Beverly Eckert. If you'd like to maybe give a quick thumbnail of who Beverly Eckert is and why we want to talk about her as a way to kind of introduce this conversation.
Sure. Beverly Eckert was the widow of a gentleman who died on 9/11. And if that wasn't bad enough, she decided on her own volition that after being through this experience and losing her husband and, you know, sitting by and watching the shenanigans carried out by the 9/11 Commission, that she would not take the $2 million payoff. And as somebody else who said, no, I'm not going to take the money, I admired her for doing that. Ella Mariani also did the same thing, and they both went up against the same attorneys from Skadden Arps who were protecting the airlines from the victims' families. So so Beverly says no to this money, and she wants to go to court. She presses on with this court case with the goal of getting everything on oath and getting everything into evidence through discovery. And, you know, lawyers are really good at taking up your life with you know, little processes and motions to dismiss and, you know, let's go into mediation. So these wives and the spouses of people who perished on 9/11 had to not only go through hell on that day, but then they had this other sort of hell start the next day. And the lawyers didn't even wait that long. They started, you know, right away before the fire, before the buildings had even fell practically, going into D.C. and getting lobbyists to go to your congresspeople to say, let's limit the liability of our corporations because otherwise it's going to hurt our economy, right? So Beverly, at one point, had given this this speech, you know, or I'm sorry, at one point she had written this article. I was referring to the wrong piece. At one point she wrote this article, and it's called "My Silence Cannot Be Bought." And I pulled it back up on the internet today, and I said, you know what? It's a shame that with her losing her life earlier this year in this plane crash, that nobody's going to hear what she has to say, and no one's going to hear the story, and no one's going to be reminded, most likely, on September 11th. And I think it's a day that when people need to hear what she had to say the most. So I asked Lisa this morning, I said, look, is there any way that you would, you know, read this article out loud? Because I don't think it's right if I would read it in, you know, a male voice or whatever. So she did, and we recorded it. And that's what I emailed to you earlier.
So let's take just a few moments and listen to Lisa Arbacheski, publisher of Tragedy and Hope magazine, and again, tragedyandhope.com, reading the late 9/11 widow and activist letter, "My Silence Cannot Be Bought."
On the 8th anniversary of 9/11, we thought it'd be important to represent the voice and the words of someone who's not here to make their own voice heard. It's an article originally published on Friday, December 19th, 2003, by Beverly Eckert, whose husband died at the World Trade Center, who herself was killed February 12th, 2009, in the crash of Continental Flight 3407 outside of Buffalo, New York. I believe Media Monarchy's episode 112 has a little bit more information on this, but the article we're presenting today by Beverly is titled, "My Silence Cannot Be Bought."
I've chosen to go to court rather than accept a payoff from the 9/11 Victims Compensation Fund. Instead, I want to know what went so wrong with our intelligence and security systems that a band of religious fanatics was able to turn 4 U.S. passenger jets into an enemy force, attack our cities, and kill 3,000 civilians with terrifying ease. I want to know why 2 110-story skyscrapers collapsed in less than 2 hours and why escape and rescue options were so limited. I am suing because, unlike other investigative avenues, including congressional hearings and the 9/11 Commission, my lawsuit requires all testimony be given under oath and fully uses powers to compel evidence. The Victims Fund was not created in a spirit of compassion. Rather, it was a tacit acknowledgement by Congress that it tampered with our civil justice system in an unprecedented way. Lawmakers capped the liability of the airlines at the behest of lobbyists who descended on Washington while the September 11th fire still smoldered. And this liability cap protects not just the airlines, but also World Trade Center builders, safety engineers, and other defendants. The caps on liability have consequences for those who want to sue to shed light on the mistakes of 9/11. It means the playing field is tilted steeply in favor of those who need to be held accountable. With the financial consequences, other than insurance proceeds, removed, there is no incentive for those whose negligence contributed to the death toll to acknowledge their failings or implement reforms. They can afford to deny culpability and play a waiting game. By suing, I forfeited the $1.8 million average award for a death claim I could have collected under the fund. Nor do I have any illusions about winning money in my suit. What I do know is I owe it to my husband, whose death, I believe, could have been avoided, to see that all of those responsible are held accountable. If we don't get answers to what went wrong, there will be a next time. And instead of 3,000 dead, it will be 10,000. What will Congress do then? So I say to Congress, big business, and everyone who conspired to divert attention from government and private sector failures, my husband's life was priceless, and I will not let his death be meaningless. My silence cannot be bought.
Those are the words of Beverly Eckert. She was a 9/11 widow, an activist, and she herself lost her life earlier this year in a plane crash that was the Continental Flight 3407. Now, as a sidebar, I conducted an interview several months ago with author and researcher Alex Constantine. So for folks that are more interested in going further into depth into Beverly Eckert and into Flight 3407, that interview is available as the podcast from MediaMonarchy.com. So the connections surrounding Beverly Eckert, for me, what sent the first red flag up when she passed away, when she died on this flight with 49 other people, I believe, she had met, I believe, 7 days prior with the new president, Barack Obama. And Beverly had been, I believe, somewhat loosely connected to people referred to as the Jersey Girls. So again, for folks, you probably heard of the Jersey Girls. Again, if not, they have a documentary called 9/11 Press for Truth that I think is a good rundown of the story of these four widows from New Jersey. So in this realm surrounding Beverly Eckert and seeing her die 7 days after talking to Obama about a new investigation was a little strange for me, and that's why I had contacted Alex Constantine, because I know he really goes down the rabbit hole in researching sort of the intelligence connections in big business. Beverly Eckert connects to what you referred to just a few minutes ago, Skadden Arps. Now, that's a law firm, and it's S-K-A-D-D-E-N-A-R-P-S, Skadden Arps, and that's not a name that folks have probably heard before.
Well, and that's one of the things that I wanted to bring to the table, because from my personal experience, when I represented myself in court pro se against EMC Corporation, which is one of the largest software corporations on the planet, the founder of EMC Corporation's Richard Egan, who was appointed ambassador by George W. Bush, ambassador to Ireland. And so they've got strong ties not only with the Bush administration, but EMC has strong ties with Israel. Now, Skadden Arps represented EMC when I took them to court, and Skadden Arps has a notorious past representing such illustrious events in U.S. history, BCCI, Iran-Contra, and as I mentioned earlier, he defends the airlines from the victims' families. So Skadden was a small firm back in the 50s, and reading from The House of Morgan by Ron Chernow from page 599, at this juncture, Morgan Stanley made another unorthodox decision. Like Morgan Guarantee, the firm had long relied on the WASP, white glove law firm of Davis, Polk, and Wardell, which had looked on takeover work as vulgar and had avoided it. With Morgan Stanley partners terrified of lawsuits ensuing from takeover work, they now wanted a tough, seasoned specialist. Greenhill insisted on hiring the experienced Joe Flom of Skadden, Arps, Slate, Marr, and Flom. So this is the go-to law firm for the Morgan firm, House of Morgan, to do hostile takeovers and transactions that the other Wall Street attorneys said that, you know, it's too dirty for us, we can't do it. So that's that's how it kind of started. And when you see them up defending the airlines against the families, you have to say, well, what's going on here? Now, when I was in court, I wasn't aware of this whole history behind Skadden. I just knew that their attorneys were like 6'7" and 6'9" respectively, and they were very imposing characters. And I came home and I was preparing a final brief at the end of my case, and I was reading this book. I come across that and I look at that. And then I realized, after doing some Googling, that Elliot Spitzer and his wife used to work for Skadden Arps. Then I recognized why Skadden questioned me so hard on Project Constellation in court, because that was brought in, it was an exhibit, it was accepted in as fact, everything in it as fact, and they wanted to persecute me for saying that Spitzer had something to do with 9/11, which is in that document, right? So that
so
was
your,
how I first...
if I can interrupt just for a second, just to clarify this, so your 2-hour recording referred to as Project Constellation was actually entered in?
Yes, indeed, and there's like a 1,200-page transcript from my court case, and I don't remember which page it's on, but there's several pages where they, you know, the whole line of questioning was around, what is Eighth Estate? Isn't it true, sir, that you believe that 9/11 wasn't done by Arab terrorists? Isn't it true, sir? You know, all this stuff. And I was like, look, it is what it is. Spitzer did what he did. AIG did what it did. Marsh did what it did. Kroll did what it did. And they represent a lot of those companies and a lot of those interests. So in hindsight, it was quite clear why they were giving me the, you know, baptism by fire, if you will.
These are the money and the corporations that seem to surround every large and pivotal event of the last several decades of not only U.S. history, but world history. So as we start to investigate some of these stories, and whether it's 9/11, or as you mentioned, BCCI, the Bank of Credit and Commerce International scandal, and its relation to Iran-Contra, and its relation to CIA and drug running. As we investigate all of these things, we do start to see the usual suspects, if you will.
Well, and you see a pattern. You see a pattern in history that's not just something you read on the website, because then I started to dig into books, because after 9/11, I discovered that the company I had worked for had unusually high trading on its stock the week before 9/11. Now, to give people some context, my client was a company called Marsh & McLennan. They're the world's largest insurance brokerage. They're partnered with AIG, who we were also developing software for. AIG was CEO'd by Hank Greenberg. His son, Jeff Greenberg, was the CEO at Marsh & McLennan. And Marsh & McLennan was located on the 96th floor of World Trade Center 1, where I had an office. And as we all know, that was the first incident to happen on 9/11. Their office exploded. So afterwards, a month later, when you find that there was excessively high stock put options being placed against the airlines, against Marsh & McLennan, and you're like, wow, how did the Arab terrorists understand our system so well that they were able to go in and make money off our stock market? But that's clever. So I wanted to see who was behind all that. And you trace it back. It goes back to this guy, Buzzy Krongard, who used to be the manager of the Deutsche Bank, Alex Brown, and Mayo Shattuck, who was in charge of these trades. And the day after 9/11, Mayo Shattuck resigns. But he gets another cushy CEO job at Constellation Energy. So Buzzy Krongard's the number three guy at the CIA. So then I was like, wow, somebody knew ahead of time. And then I started hitting the books, because I realized that everything I thought I knew wasn't actually true.
And this story of insider trading is documented. And in doing a lot of my preparation and research and pre-production for not only this interview, but for also my 8th anniversary episode tomorrow, episode 140 of MediaMonarchy.com, I've essentially been using the historycommons.org complete 9/11 timeline in conjunction with something put up by a guy named Jonathan Elinoff, who's behind a documentary series called coreofcorruption.com. He has posted up, and I believe at current count, 153 videos as a playlist on YouTube of nothing but mainstream media, TV, ABC, NBC, CBS, Fox, going all the way back to at least the 70s, and covering many of the things that we've just now mentioned, whether it's drug running or money scandals or anthrax or 9/11. I put together and looked at some of the bigger pieces and some of the related things, and the insider trading is one that you can look at and see, well, it was covered, they talked about it, and it instantly went away. So it's there, but in the days and weeks and even months post 9/11, the insider trading is one of those stories that slowly went by the wayside. I think as we look around right now, we should see that with our bailouts and crumbling economy, that again, you know, as we just said, you and other people have been talking about the funny money dealings for a long time. So again, past is prologue.
Well, I'd like to say that Elinoff is a sharp researcher, and he's an excellent filmmaker, and his movie is not a minute too long. I think that everything he's trying to do as far as offer out all those clips, I've seen all those clips, I've got them in our site on a community as well posted. And it's like, look, we all need to realize that the media did a lot of useful work for us. They have a lot of media clips out there that haven't been corrupted yet, and these can be preserved and studied and used to put together the story. They didn't tell us the truth about what happened that day, but the truth is scattered throughout those pieces, because you can see what pieces they wanted to take away right away and say, look, we published that, but we're not going to talk about it again. It's just like Dan Rather talking about the 1993 World Trade Center bombing and Ahmad Salem. Right? That's there. You can show people that clip, but they talk today like it never happened. So, you know, corporate media has a sharper edge, because they give you 50% of the information, but what you really need is the 50% they can't give you, because it hurts their advertisers. Right?
And you nailed it right there. It hurts their advertisers. This message brought from Fox and all those regular guys that people would at least recognize and trust to some degree. And it's those kind of things, again, that I feel are really effective in trying to communicate a lot of this information to folks. So it's not some scary documentary with spooky music to tell you when something bad is being talked about. It's just here it is. Here's that thing that ran, you know, on your television back in the 70s or 80s or 90s or 2000s. It's that kind of stuff that, again, for folks who are either combative or unwilling or who honestly perhaps don't care about any kind of research such as what we're talking about.
Well, and that ties back into belief because, you know, we are victimized by our beliefs. I think, you know, we are infected by inaccurate perspectives. And I think that, you know, when you look at belief only exists absent certain facts that otherwise, if those facts were present, the belief would be eradicated, right? So the beliefs are all kind of like our blind spots, the things that we didn't actually look at or experience for ourselves, but we have this idea about what happened. That's a belief. And you know what? I bet when you examine that situation closely, it's not nearly as, you know, you were presented it, because I think a lot of people not listening to this podcast, of course, but I'm trying to help your audience be able to communicate with their family and friends and other people who don't do enough autodidactic activity in their life, not enough self-learning. And I think it's important for us to be able to be, you know, build a bridge. So we have to be able to articulate that, you know, people have become infected with media memes and advertisements and things that allow us to, in our minds, dehumanize people on the other side of the world. And it's like, you know, personally, when you're willing to hate no one, then you'll have peace for yourself. And it's not until you have peace for yourself, are you a responsible person to go out and spread this type of information? Because if you have to come from an aspect of fear, either you haven't done enough homework or you're not a good enough salesperson to sell without fear.
And I think that's what took me a longer time to feel confident in trying to have a news blog or a radio show. It took a few years of me studying this stuff more or less secretively, because in 2002 and 2003, it wasn't exactly common discussion to talk about 9/11 questions. So I spent several years reading a lot, listening a lot, watching all the documentaries, going through all the bits and pieces that at some point I realized, okay, I don't believe every single word of this, but ultimately I've seen enough to know that in most of these instances that we're talking about, I don't know exactly what happened. I'm not postulating theories. All I know is that the official story can't be true. So hopefully...
That's a great starting place. Because I don't know either, but that's what keeps people like myself, yourself, your audience, like alive and surviving, because we are aware, we are conscious, we're paying attention, we're learning, we're growing, we're communicating, we're taking ourselves and putting ourselves in uncomfortable situations, less than comfortable surroundings to do what we do, because there's easier ways to go do, and if you wanted to go make money, there's 100 easier ways to go do anything. This is the hardest way to kind of scratch out a living, because you got to work 3 jobs, basically, you know, in order to keep yourself running over there, right, James?
Just about. Yeah. And I even, you know, there are times, and just even this last week, and I find myself kind of stewing about it as we're approaching the anniversary, and I have a lot of research and a lot of things on my plate for Media Monarchy, all kind of culminating in this weekend. But a couple of nights ago, this is just a sidebar, and we'll get back on track in just a moment, I went out after work. There was a going-away party for a girl who's leaving the store that I work at. So we went to essentially a dive karaoke bar, and I had a blast drinking and dancing and singing and having a good old time, and was able for a few moments to kind of forget and not think about what is really going down and what we're really being faced with, in a way almost feeling sometimes guilty that, you know, what are you doing out dancing and singing karaoke? There's a lot of important work to do. It's hard not to get bogged down with all of this. And again, it's hard to juggle the sort of, I made the joke to you, I believe, earlier this day. It's like, gee, it's hard to live 3 lives, which is, of course, a tongue-in-cheek reference to Lee Harvey Oswald. It's hard to be a news radio guy as well as a good employee, as well as a good, cool boyfriend and friend, to juggle all those things. But again, I'm getting off the beaten path here. I think to get us back on track, what you said earlier is what we need to do now is hit the books.
Hit the books, but it's also important to keep balance. You're absolutely right. I mean, I get that comment from my fiance all the time that, you know, all I do is I wake up in the morning, I spend 18 hours a day figuring out like what this map is, because the map they gave us is not accurate of the terrain. So we had to create a new map, and I think it would be irresponsible for us to start leading people without a map and not having gotten to the place they want to get to. I feel very comfortable having given, you know, what we've traversed as far as information and connecting these dots, that it will be a long time before, you know, people are able to go outside of this mapped area, because it spans basically all civilized history. And if you go back to the origin of writing and language, and in fact back when they invented something called money and currency, and how it was used to, you know, subvert populations. If you couldn't get the military might, you would use currency. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's stay on point here.
Well, I think it's a sense of urgency that I think probably drives us on, because it feels like in a way things are rapidly accelerating. I'm not one who says the world is going to end tomorrow or even on 2012 or anything like that, but definitely things seem to be heading for the worst. And right now we have the ability to plug a cheap microphone into a little mixer and plug that into a laptop, and we can speak over the internet, and hopefully many, many, many people can hear this and we can get it out. However, just like the videos that we share and that we save and that we get from YouTube and these archives and these podcasts and all of this work could disappear if the internet shuts off tomorrow.
Yeah, if we lose electricity, it's really hard to share podcasts and stuff.
Which would bring us back to having books.
Books. I like books. All right. So people, I think, when you get into these blind spots and what do they believe and how do they have these beliefs set up? Well, I'm sure you know how your beliefs are set up, and I know how mine were set up, but we all kind of only have an idea of how we were all conditioned. And then you realize we're all kind of conditioned very similarly. And is it for our own good? Is it for our own survival? Do they teach us about money and how all the things that we need to know? No, they teach us what we need to know to go work at their corporations, and they get us to pay $100,000 so we can pre-qualify ourselves and they can save some money, right? Knowing that we're already bought in, we're indebted, we're indentured slaves, and we're going to be, you know, debt slaves for the rest of our lives, because once you get a mortgage, which in French, by the way, is death pledge, which in, you know, Quebec, they call it a hypothèque instead of a mortgage, because no one would sign a death pledge if you speak French, right?
It's within this language that we can start to see really what's going on, but please continue.
So I went through their training system. I'm like, this is awesome. I went out and got a job. I'm like, this is awesome. I earned my first $1 million by the time I was 30. I was like, this is awesome. And then I discovered, oh, wow, there's a whole lot of information they keep from the rest of us to keep us under control. And I guess the first book that I read that really made the impression on me that I had no clue what was going on if I just relied on what they showed me was this book called Tragedy and Hope by a professor who had taught at Princeton and Harvard and Georgetown. And he was the professor who taught Rhodes Scholar Bill Clinton and was his mentor. So when I got this book, it's huge. It's like, I don't know, it's like 2 or 3 inches thick, 2,000 pages basically. I'm sorry, 1,300 pages.
It's a massive, daunting, and sometimes actually really hard or expensive to find tome.
Well, exactly. In 2004, this book was like, it was out of print, and anything on any of the book exchanges were like $1,300 and above, $1,400. And I was like, why is this book so expensive? And it's obvious they don't want people to be reading this all over the place, right?
That's now, cost prohibitive, I believe, is how you would call that.
Now, today you can get the book for like $40. I've got a link to an electronic version so people can follow along with this. But basically, I was only 51 pages in, and it had blown my entire mind, because it says, the greatest of these dynasties, of course, were the descendants of Meyer Amschel Rothschild of Frankfurt, right? And it goes on and talks about his five sons. I was like, wait a minute, this is crazy conspiracy stuff. I've only seen this like on the web. This was pre-YouTube. So I've only seen people rant and rave on these poorly formatted websites. And I'm like, that's never been anything credible. And then all of a sudden, here's the guy who taught Bill Clinton. And he's talking about, well, yes, it's happened. You know, it's very good history. And I was like, wow, how did they never teach us this in school? Well, then I got a couple, I got to page like 1059, and it's talking about these different oil cartels and how they're taking over, you know, all over the world. And it's talking about Dulles and these guys at the CIA crushing Mossadegh in Iran, Operation, what was that operation called?
Ajax.
Yeah. And it says in here on page 1059, Colonel Norman H. Norman Schwarzkopf, former head of the Jersey State Police, who was in charge of training the Imperial Iranian Gendarmerie, right? So Schwarzkopf from the Iraq Gulf War in 91.
He's a rock star.
Yeah, totally, man. So he comes from a famous family, was involved in all this stuff. So I was like, well, you know, that's interesting. But, you know, what does it really say about what's going on? He goes into the CFR, and he's like, I have no aversion to all this stuff. In fact, he studied their records for 20 years writing this book, right? So he was on the inside. I thought Council on Foreign Relations was something that conspiracy theorists cooked up, right? And so here's this whole book on the history of Cecil Rhodes and his will. And in his will, which, by the way, when you try to get that 1902 book, it's not any place. It's basically not a law library. So I have an electronic copy of that, and your audience can go through, and you can see clearly that he wanted to create a secret society based on the tenets of the Jesuits only to progress the British Empire. And then he expresses his woe that, you know, the American colonies slipped away, and that it would be much easier to create a one world order if America was still part of Britain. And so they went about creating the Federal Reserve and the Council on Foreign Relations and these entities, Tavistock and whatnot, to control not only, you know, our population's minds through media, but the global population through media. And so you have these bankers. And I was like, wow, I had this whole education I'm still paying for. I made all this money. I thought I knew, and I never had a clue. You know, and then I thought about all the clients that I had and the different software applications they like to build.
Now,
I had second thoughts, yeah.
We'll make the quick mention that Carol Quigley, the author of Tragedy and Hope, was someone important enough to Bill Clinton that he mentioned him. Was it in his inaugural speech?
Yeah, it was when he got inaugurated.
So, Bill Clinton, the sort of, you know, the guy that no one had really ever heard of, who came up, you know, with a well-styled campaign and playing saxophone on the Arsenio Hall show and things. This cool new guy comes in, but in his inaugural speech, he knows to make a verbal reference to Carol Quigley in Tragedy and Hope. I believe the other side note that we do want to make is going into Carol Quigley, my man James Corbett of CorbettReport.com, I think, goes well into Carol Quigley in episode 58 of Corbett Report.
He does. He does, absolutely, because as soon as he published that, I was like, oh, somebody else is putting information out there about it, and that's less that I have to do. It's less responsibility I have, because my perspective is, as long as some people out there are aware of these things, and I, you know, it could bring a great deal of clarity. I just hadn't seen anyone except yourself, James Corbett, and a few other people talk about any of this, and then that's what kind of spurred me into you know, digging deeper and checking into these books. Now, in this other Carol Quigley book, The Anglo-American Establishment, on page 170, he explains the British decision behind backing Israel and going against the Arabs and basically giving Palestine to a pro-Zionist future state. And he says the general attitude of the Milner Group, which was one of the outcomes of Cecil Rhodes' will, was neither pro-Arab nor pro-Zionist, right? And then he goes in to say, look, the British had been among these people with T.E. Lawrence and whatnot, and they were very affable and they enjoyed the presence of the Arabs. Basically, Quigley lays out that the reason that the British Empire went with British Israelism was twofold. The British royalty claimed to be descendants of, you know, a great biblical king. So it's convenient for them to take on this illusion, if you will. And the other thing was that the pro-Zionists controlled their banks. And they said the Arabs don't control any commerce. We can't make any money with them. We can make money by making war with them. And at the end of the day, that's what the internationals do. They create wars so they can gain money and power, because they're afraid of you understanding what they know, and they want to control you. So it's that simple.
So now we've mentioned what, you know, the I word, Israel, and when we start to talk about Israel or Zionism, red flags go up for people and they maybe start to tense up. But again, we're talking about something that's all pretty fairly well documented in the Anglo-American establishment. And then doesn't this relate to September 11th in yet another way?
Well, sure, because he says on page 172, he's like, He's talking about Lord Milner and how they create this thing called the Balfour Declaration, which was actually a letter, a receipt for a trading of the land. Now, the British promised the land to three different groups, and then they came to, you know, be pressed to make a decision, and they decided to create a future Zionist state on September 11th, 1922. You can check the internet. That's the actual mandate to create Palestine into a future Zionist state, which happened, you know, like 20 years later. And that was the fallout from the Balfour Declaration, which was a promise by men who did not own that land to give that land to other men who did not own that land for purposes of gaining power over a group of people, the Muslims, that they couldn't easily control through TV or mechanized war.
So going back to what may seem in a way like ancient history, but as we're talking about Cecil Rhodes and Carol Quigley and the Milner Group and these sort of roundtables, this is essentially the foundation of what has been built in America over the last couple of hundred years. And it's where all, I think, the bad, the sinister forces, if you will, where they sort of originate and where they were planted here in this country.
Well, and I think it's another thing. It's like the blind spot that we have is that there was this guy, Cecil Rhodes, who now has a country named after him, Rhodesia, who was in charge of creating apartheid. He was basically in charge of creating institutionalized racism in South Africa. He made all his money on diamonds and gold, and all of his assets through his will were turned over to the Rhodes Scholar Trust and this secret society, which is, you know, run by the people who funded Cecil Rhodes, which is the Rothschild banking family. And you can go to any Barnes & Noble and go and ask on for the books on the Rothschild family. It's a two-volume set, and it's not conspiracy like I thought it was. I went to the bookstore, and I got the books, and I was like, wow, this is history. It's full of conspiracy because that's how they gain power. It's full of counter-conspiracy because that's how they retain power. But it's absolutely historical, and I think that they've been growing us dumb, and anyone who believes that there is no conspiracy in the world definitely has not read any good history books.
And even the very word conspiracy has been twisted into being a sort of, it's a slur. And it's something that you say that word and that means you're crazy cuckoo and you're talking about chupacabras and aliens and all that, right?
Well, I think that really indicates first it's a shortcut to thinking. And B, it's a sign that the person you're talking to has been highly conditioned such that the utterance of one word can make them emotionally react about a situation they have not studied, that they have not applied any critical thinking to, and they haven't thought about objectively, which is why they're emotionally responding instead of intellectually debating. That the point of debate is to bring these two opposite sides together and sharpen each other, not break each other, because you want to refine your points. And you can't argue with idiots or clowns or kooks. So, I mean, at the end of the day, everyone has a right. If they want to be ignorant, leave them alone. I'm only trying to get the information to the people who are seeking the answers, because there are families out there who've been lied to. Those families need to know that the evidence exists to point them in the right direction. They need to know that we've taken that evidence to the lawyers like Ron Motley, who claim to represent you, a billionaire attorney who claims to represent 4,000 families, and they pocket the evidence and say, we don't need to follow this, because it leads from the Arab people they're following back to Wall Street bankers. And that doesn't fit their case. So it gets put in a drawer, and Ron Motley's firm never tells you guys anything about what goes on or what was turned over to them. So when I went out and looked for people in the world who I could trust with the information I had, I found out the hard way and found out, you know, like falling off a cliff, that there's no leadership. There's no one minding the store. Everybody is looting this whole place. There's no longer an authority that doesn't have an authority above that that's going to shut down any investigation that any leader says that they're going to do. So the only answer is reelect no one. No one who has been elected, as far as I'm concerned or I can see, has done the job properly, because some people might claim that there's a politician out there and his name's so-and-so and he's doing a great job. He's going to be leader of America. I got news for you. He's been saying that shit for 20 years. Hasn't happened yet. You are the future. It's you that you should be concerned about. Educate yourself and figure out what is going on and be the change that you see needs to take place in the world.
That's exactly it. And that's paraphrasing Gandhi, is it not? Be the change you want to see in the world.
When I also advise people not to idolize people like Gandhi. He's just a regular dude like you or me. He made mistakes. He's a human being. And while he denied his wife I think it was quinine, and she died, he actually took the drug to save his life. So, you know, that all being said, he did a lot of great things. There's a lot of great examples. I just don't like anyone who's an equal human being with me, like following somebody else around without looking or giving all this gratitude to false heroes, because I went out and I had all my false heroes broken because I realized these people were taking the money and they're very happy to do it. So you got to be your own leader. You got to stand up for yourself. You got to make yourself into the person you see needs to be out there.
I think that's
what we try to do here.
I think that's absolutely, absolutely right. If I can pull back again a moment, and I'm somewhat reluctantly making the analogy of a pyramid, that if we have these Rothschilds and all the other sort of names and handfuls of families, that again, it wasn't in a conspiracy book, it was in that dusty biography corner of the bookstore. They kind of set this foundation for us that we've seen, and again, I can only speak best in a way about, you know, American history. I'm a West Virginia boy, small upbringing and all of that, but it's those guys that have seemed to sort of set up the structure that has what you just referred to. It's they start the wars, they make the money, they play both ends against the middle. They do these things that cast shadows on the wall and to generally keep us on that playing field. And
it keeps us. Allegory of the Cave. I mean, that's exactly what you're talking about. It's the Allegory of the Cave. Read it. It's still going on 2,000 years later. People don't understand. They're watching the shadows on the wall. And we are talking about more real things after which the models you think are real are created. I mean, that's how it rolls. I'm looking at a book here called The History of the Supreme Court of the United States, published in 1918 by Gustavus Myers. In here, he talks about Supreme Court Justice Morrison R. Waite and his close ties to the corporations and all these railroad companies. He was buddies with the Harrimans and the Rockefellers and the Vanderbilts. And, you know, he's doing all this great work for them. And he is the Supreme Court Justice who, in two sentences and without any debate, gave corporations the same rights as human beings. Only corporations have no body to prosecute and no soul to save. So their ideals, their goals, their needs are 180 degrees, you know, divergent from what we need as human beings. So corporations' interests are in conflict directly with human interests because of something that some skull and bones Chief Justice of the Supreme Court said in 1886 in two sentences that plagues our world today, because without corporations having the same actions and abilities as people legally, we wouldn't have all this toxicity throughout our environment, because corporations also externalize their true cost of producing products to you, either by poisoning your environment or poisoning you through their products directly. And that's why advertising doesn't work in corporate media, because it's more profitable to, you know, censor and suppress information that would embarrass a Monsanto or a Bayer or any of these other pharmaceutical companies or military industrial companies that are preying on us daily. Well, there might be people in your audience who say, well, you know, I don't believe in conspiracies. I still don't believe you. I've read these books. I don't believe you. Well, here's Fire in the Minds of Men, Origins of the Revolutionary Faith by James H. Billington, who was not only a Librarian of Congress, but he's also a Rhodes Scholar. And let's see what he talks about in here. Oh, he's talking about the Masons and different fraternities and secret societies and, oh, the occult origins of organization. So he's basically saying all the organizations, including, you know, Bavarian Illuminism and Freemasonry and the other things he's talking about in this great big thick book, all exist. And, you know, only people who don't know about it are the victims, because victims don't read books. And that's kind of how you determine if you're a victim or not. Are you reading their books and understanding and bypassing their shell game, or are you playing into it every day, right? Because, you know, we're allowed to maintain these beliefs about, you know, what we think America is because of the media companies. But look, you know, in March 1915, this is a statement by U.S. Congressman Oscar Calloway in 1917, and he states, in March 1915, the J.P. Morgan interests, the steel, shipbuilding, and powder interest, that means they make powder for war, and their subsidiary organizations got together 12 men high up in the newspaper world and employed them to select the most influential newspapers in the United States and sufficient number of them to control generally the policy of the daily press. They found it was necessary to purchase control of only 25 of the greatest newspapers. An agreement was reached, the policy of the papers was bought, to be paid for by the month as a subscription. An editor was furnished for each paper to properly supervise and edit information regarding the questions of preparedness, militarism, financial policies, and other things of national and international nature considered vital to the interest of the purchasers.
This leads us directly into talking about what we're stewing in today, and whether it's public relations or media control. I wanted to make a reference as we were speaking about what is referred to, I believe, as corporate personhood. One of the few places I think I've ever really seen this discussed in any kind of mainstream avenue was, I believe, the documentary The Corporation, which, I, if memory serves correct, uses as its jumping off point the idea that, and it introduced this idea and this fact that what you said, those two sentences, made corporations like a person. Is what kind of person would that corporation be if you could lay that person down on an analyst couch? What kind of person would they be if you sort of looked them over? And they would ultimately be a sociopath, because they act with complete disregard for anyone else, don't seem to learn from their mistakes, and on and on. And on. They would be a dick. They would be a nut. They would be someone you wouldn't want to hang out with.
You definitely wouldn't want them feeding, clothing, educating your children. And it's corporate psychopathy. The way corporations are programmed in the operating systems that are the legal documents of that corporation, it is mandated to profit at all cost and to return a profit to the shareholders. And that's it. It doesn't matter if they poison you. It doesn't matter if they kill the environment, global warming, doesn't matter. And in order to fix that, ironically enough, there was an attorney who spent 23 years working for Skadden Arps. His name's Robert Hinckley. He's now retired, and he saw the error of his ways and saw that lawyers are really what's behind all of these little nuances that we can't figure out, because he said, if we were to change the corporate mandate, corporate law, and you put these additional 26 words in, it says corporations must profit, but not at the expense of human or environmental suffering, et cetera, these 26 words would directly, because it's an operating system, change the behavior of all these corporations, because at the end of the day, it is greed. There is some evil going on, but it's also just how the corporations are set up to run, because the people who created these corporations years ago in the mandates said, hey, let's make the corporations act as sociopaths so we can use them as proxies, and the people who hide above those corporations and use those corporations against us would be protected and would never meet the guillotine.
If we could make a sort of computer analogy, that those words by a Skull and Bonesman is essentially bad code. It's malware. And if Hinckley was able to put in this addendum, it would be like fixing, it would fix the HTML code. It would fix the malware, the spyware, the thing that's infected you and your brain, if I can use a belabored IT analogy.
That's what a meme is. A meme is a mind virus, right? And so they put this mind virus in to dehumanize people, not to give them the benefit of the doubt. Don't critical think. Go off and shut your mind off. If you hear the words conspiracy or Holocaust or any of these words, just automatically cut people off. And, you know, just know that war is profitable, and keep poisoning yourselves for their profit. And, you know, even though it doesn't make any sense, it makes sense for them. Dollars and cents. It makes money for them. And that's why all the ludicrous actions of the corporations can be explained just by understanding the nature of their self. And it's corporate psychopathy. And then you see it's all run by what makes money for them. And so what makes money for corporations is not what keeps humanity alive. It is not what allows us to enjoy and actually catch happiness and not just pursue it with our families and friends. We need more than what's being given.
Devil's advocate would say, but if you say that they make all the money anyway, then why would they need to do all these things to control this money that they print anyway?
Oh, they use the money. The money's just to control you. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a totally different currency among the elite so they know who each other are. I mean, when you think about the money that they've given us, it's not even worth the paper it's printed on, because nothing is more worthless than a currency that has gone through hyperinflation and has crashed. It turns into wallpaper. I mean, you know, in 1920s in Germany, it took 4 billion Reichmarks or 4 billion marks to buy a glass of beer. That is what hyperinflation does. So it doesn't matter if you are a millionaire or a $20 or $30, $50 million person. we're all equally broke when hyperinflation hits, and they do what they've already planned to do with their currency. That's why they put it here. That's why they created this whole bubble over the past 100 years to drain America of our, you know, our wealth as Americans has been exported. And we are being left holding a flaming bag of shit. And it's not cool. And we don't have to sit around and do nothing about it. We can get organized. You can get yourself a study group, a list of these 10 books that I'm going to give James at the end of the interview. And you can go and do something about this. But before you do, you have to know the angle they're playing. And you have to understand the rules of their game so that you can go through and, you know, circumvent their rules.
We could make the reference right here, and I think we've probably done it before, that ultimately we're dealing with gangsters, and I think you've called them multi-generational serial killers, or even, you know, sociopaths. If we can reference Goodfellas, when they're running the restaurant, and they're essentially just using it as a front to move liquor and drugs and God knows what through, and ultimately when they've run out of all the money they can borrow, beg, or steal, they decide to burn the place down. Once they've looted it and there's nothing else, they go in and burn it down themselves and collect the insurance. It rather feels like that's what's happening to this country right now. The gangsters have just about looted anything left, and they're getting ready to burn the place down and stick us with the bill, those of us still around.
Yeah, totally. It's a group of gang bankers. And what they need to know is that Wall Street's hit its dead end. We're pulling the U-turn. We know how to set up our own currency in this country. We're not going to let foreigners control our own bank. We're going to follow the Constitution and have our own currency printed by our own Congress. And once international banking has broken its trust with the people, they no longer have any power because their entire currency is based on the trust that you give them when you believe in that little piece of paper with their talismans and sigils and all the little esoteric, little hidden things they think they're cool for doing. Well, it's worthless to me. I don't work for money anymore. Thanks for breaking my beliefs. I learned a lot in the last 10 years. You know, that's how I feel about it. It's like, you know, I used to think and I used to hate George Bush. I used to hate these people because I'm like, oh my God, they're so evil. But you know what? I was dumb. I was dumb as a rock. No matter what I thought, I was dumb until George Bush and these neocons and the Illuminati and all these other, you know, however you want to classify these people, Committee of 300. It's just people who print the money and they have obscene amounts of it and they have very different needs than you or I. Carl Jung once said the cause of all mental illness is the avoidance of legitimate suffering. And so what that means is people who have billions or trillions of dollars don't go through a whole lot of you know, legitimate suffering every day. They don't hear the word no ever because people around them want their money. So they always hear the word yes, so they're allowed to do whatever they want. And if they want to, you know, vaccinate these kids in Africa and give them, you know, some sort of thing that sterilizes them or kills them, hey, no big deal. Let's put billions of dollars into that, and that's a great idea because all these people, when you look at it, are all involved in something called eugenics. Everyone from Alexander Graham Bell to the whole Darwin evolution gang to the Harriman family, the Bush family, the Rockefeller family, they all want to sterilize your kids. That's what, the, you know, it's 150-year history that I couldn't believe. Oh, my God, look at the plans.
Well, I have to say that it does so much seem to come back to eugenics, which I believe just roughly translates as good birth, good you know, good genes, good birth, or it's basically the science of building a better baby, essentially.
From, you know, eugenics, I got into, you know, I checked out, there's all these books and people who have commented on it, and I was like, I didn't believe this. I couldn't believe that these types of things are going on. And you bump into books like Thomas Malthus's work or The Next Million Years by Charles Galton Darwin, or Julian Huxley had written quite a bit about this, and he goes on to create things called, you know, UNESCO, and this other interesting organization called the World Wildlife Fund. So the eugenicists create the World Wildlife Fund, and if you were one of the lucky people to see that video this week, their new promotion, their scare tactic, their fear tactic, showing this hundreds of planes crashing in on New York, and then trying to compare that to natural disasters and tsunamis, saying respect nature. Right? I mean, it was a complete fear campaign. Did you see, were you privy to that video?
No, I don't know if I saw a still that came from some advertising agency. I believe this is the same thing, that it's, you know, it's a sort of Photoshop idea of dozens of planes descending on Manhattan.
Yeah, they have a very distasteful CGI rendering of the first plane hitting the North Tower, the second plane hitting the South Tower. then they're like, in 2001, 2,000 people died, or 3,000 people died on 9/11, and they give the stats, and then they said, in 2005, 200,000 people died in a tsunami. That's like 100 9/11s, and nature is awesome, so respect it, or it'll kick your ass. I mean, that was the whole basis of the commercial. I was like, one has nothing to do with the other, except they're both being controlled and manipulated by eugenicists who believe that they deserve to, be left here with this planet by themselves, with depopulation and all sorts of other plans that they have been dumb enough to write down. I mean, when you get into H.G. Wells's work and the new Machiavelli's, the New World Order, these ideas come out and he's presenting them. It's not unlike Colonel House's work. And this takes me back to Tragedy and Hope and page 930, where Carol Quigley says, hey, this myth, like all fables, does have a fact of modicum of truth. And he says these roundtable groups exist, the Council on Foreign Relations, this dominant Rhodes Trust and how they manipulate the world. And Carol Quigley says, I have no aversion to this. And J.P. Morgan and Rockefeller and the Whitney families are all involved. And it's like, when there's so much you don't know that they're using to keep you in the dark, it's no wonder that people believe the official story. So I don't blame anybody for not seeing around this. It's very complicated, and you have to do a lot of work to see what James and I are talking about. And I think a lot of people in your audience are hip to that, but they have, trouble communicating that to other people. We haven't been able to reach critical mass and getting people to understand yet.
I wanted yet being the operative word. I wanted to reference and mention a couple things as we're talking about these families, and we're talking about, the Rockefellers and the Rothschilds, and you even just mentioned H.G. Wells, which of course most folks know him from Time Machine and War of the Worlds and things like that, but he also wrote books with titles called The Open Conspiracy and New World Order.
Right.
And these guys that we earlier on referred to as multi-generational serial killers or gangsters, and whether or not there's only, a dozen families in these special bloodlines that control everything, I'm not quite convinced of. In a way, I think you've made the analogy that it's perhaps also like a high-stakes poker table that people have been able, through the last century or so, to been able to sort of buy their way in. And there, I think, is where we see the sort of the Bill Gateses and the Ted Turners. And then that brings us to eugenics.
Bill Gates' father takes you right to eugenics. His dad was in charge of Planned Parenthood, which is a Rockefeller operation, and it was basically focused toward the lower classes, and it's a type of, racial hygiene in practice, which was invented in the United States and then exported through its financiers to Germany, right? And it's like, if we just depend on what they taught us in school, then we are exactly as dumb as they want us to be, because they taught you only what they wanted you to know, and they held back what they didn't want you to see. And it's like, for people to continue to trust media after there are quotes out there, here's Richard Salant, former president of CBS News. He said, our job is to give people not what they want, but what we decide they ought to have. He's deciding what you should have to make decisions. And, if you're not exactly where you want to be in the world, it's because the information you're using to make your decisions is not based on as, close to reality as it could be. There's many other quotes that illustrate this, but the point is that unless you create your own media company, then you really never know from these other companies that are publicly traded for-profit corporations. They take all these crazy ads for pharmaceuticals and Monsanto products. I mean, they, you have to understand, they don't have the same, interest. You're interested in like clean water, clean, fresh food, having happiness with your family, having some security, healthcare, things like this. Those people, they're worried about, who getting a bigger yacht than Larry Ellison or earning more than Larry Ellison next year, They have totally different priorities. And we just have to recognize that. It's nothing you need to hate,
And it's these guys, again, and what we've referenced throughout this talk is that they've written it down. And it's in books, and it's in white papers written by white guys. And as you have noted before, as said by Alan Dulles, who was the director of the CIA, who I believe was fired by John F. Kennedy, yet then Alan Dulles was appointed to investigate the assassination of John F. Kennedy. Alan Dulles said, in referencing the Warren Commission report, well, the American, they don't read.
Yeah, that's how they'll believe it. They don't read it. Because the 9/11 Commission report, when I read that, I lost all faith in any commission or anyone else doing justice for us, because it's like I gave the benefit of the doubt to the people who we supposedly elected as our leaders, because I was naive enough to think that's how they got there, you know, at that time. But after I read the 9/11 commission report, I mean, I was totally beside myself, because not only did they leave out a bunch of key facts that I knew about and were, you know, readily known, and these people were trying to testify, but then, you know, the people who ran it were almost like the ghouls and gangsters who oversaw the whole operation in the first place. And it's like, it's almost like the whole thing was an intelligence operation. And in the days right after 9/11, the FBI went to something called the Whitney Museum. Now, the Whitney family helped to found Skull and Bones, along with the Russell family and whatnot. They have a museum in New York. It's a very expensive, very posh, very exclusive museum. And they had the work of this gentleman named Mark Lombardi hanging in their galleries. Now, Mark did this type of art called network diagramming. And what he would do is he'd write somebody's name, and then he'd draw a circle, and then he'd draw a circle to all the people they did business with. And then you'd have a big diagram, you know, it's called global networks, that would tell you who does business with who and where the money goes and where the money flows. And he tracked all these unusual transactions with the Vatican back scandal and the SNL scandal and the BCCI scandal and George Bush and Bin Laden family doing business, you know, for, you know, since 1977. This was all in his art. It was on the walls. The FBI went to the Whitney Museum, and the Whitney said, well, you can't have a private showing. You can see it with the public. And that's it, basically saying you can't study this stuff. Now, oddly enough, Mark Lombardi was found dead on March 22nd, 322 of 2000. So on 3/22/2000, this guy who's putting Skull and Bones money laundering skills and schemes into his art is found hung right before one of his biggest showings and a rise in his popularity. The Whitney Museum and the Jewish Museum in New York exclusively own all of Mark Lombardi's work, and it's no longer on public showing, so the only way you can really see it is in this book that's on Amazon.com. Now.
Well, but again, as we're mentioning the Whitney Museum, it's something that, you know, my brother went to New York to do graphic design and to do art. He said, you know, many years ago, I want to be in the Whitney Biennial. So it's something that, you know, up and coming artists want to be involved in. And when you see someone like Mark Lombardi and his work, and at the pivotal moment where he was about to gain a wider audience for his work, he kills himself.
Well, they just, you know, from a conspiratorial side, I guess, because I don't believe he hung himself to one degree. And Jerry Mazza had also done some research and investigation, looked at the police reports, and it stinks. The whole thing stinks. But I guess the point would be, it was a Democracy Now! Program where they basically talked to the curator who was taking his work on tour. And after noticing that his books produced by the Rothschild Foundation and the Whitney family, I found it very interesting that they had a very limited showing of his work post 9/11, let people see it, but then they put it away. And I thought, how tragic for all that work to get put away so easily. So what I started doing was, for the past 6 years, I've used this software called The Brain, and you can get it at thebrain.com. And basically, I've loaded all the types of things that Mark put into his art, only I put it into an interactive electronic format where it clicks to the Wikipedia pages and connects all the facts together. And so with these 3,500 ideas of you know, people and events and where the money goes, it illustrates and answers all your questions. And on topics you don't know about, then you can go in and search that topic and see what it connects to that you might know about. You can learn your way out from there. So it's kind of how, you know, we do appreciate the fact that somebody before us did try to leave some information behind to make our job easier of figuring out what exactly is going on and how do we make informed decisions for ourselves and learn to think critically to survive, you know, other people who have plans of eugenicizing the rest of us.
I think the connection and the confluence of art and corporations is really an interesting one, and we should probably discuss it for just a few moments. But to set the table like we already did, with the idea that, you know, this well-connected elite family's museum owns this artist's controversial work, it kind of reminds me, too, as we'll see films and shows and things that come out and seem to sort of pull the curtain back on things, and you want to think, oh, wow, you know, Warner Brothers or Miramax or Epitaph Records or whatever it is, boy, they're really, you know, how did they get away with this? They're really, you know, sticking it to the man showing this kind of information. It's an amazing kind of control over most art, and it's almost a kind of bragging.
Well, I mean, first off, culture is a collection of human expression, and the environment we find ourselves in today is devoid of human expression. All you have around you is corporate expression, corporate produced programs, movies, magazines, everything's out there for profit, made by somebody who doesn't even own the company. They're just working there because they're shareholders and, you know, yada, yada, yada. At the end of the day, human expression and art are the solutions to the apathy and the ignorance that we've been practicing over the past several years. We have a wake-up call. We have a chance to use our energy and focus it creatively and try to get more human culture out there so we can communicate with each other and, you know, kind of get on the same page and survive. To your other point, there's an excellent film, although it's sharp, it's got a sharp edge in all the wrong ways, is called The American Ruling Class. And basically this character who used to, you know, his family is from the elite, wealthy family. His family is in politics. He was in charge of Harper's Magazine for years. And he gets this whole movie together where he has these two guys basically from, you know, Yale and Ivy League schools go around and try to find out, is there an American ruling class? He's got interviews with James Baker and all these characters in there, the people that run New York Times, people that run other established authorities, Council on Foreign Relations. All of these things are in there. They're factual. You see the people who run them. They're in the film. They're playing along. They're letting you know because they're letting you know on their pace, on their scale, and at the rate that they're comfortable with, which is exactly what they want. So you've got this great tool called The American Ruling Class. You can show that movie to other people who will not believe that there is something credible to what's going on. I mean, I got another book over here called Superclass by David Rothkopf. He's a member of Council on Foreign Relations. What we have to realize in this country is that from the beginning of the 20th century, at the very least, our educations were being adversely influenced. You could say that these educational institutions, these ruling foundations, had a gravity-like effect because they were basically controlling all the content. They took out historians who told the history that they didn't like. They created and taught and trained and vetted historians who told the stories they wanted to tell. The entire everything that we were taught in school has been manipulated, and that's on congressional record. That comes from somebody who is an insider. It comes from the director of research for the Reese Committee, which went on in the 50s, to study what is the influence of these global foundations, the Rockefeller Foundation, the Guggenheim Foundation, the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. And basically, as Norman Dowd recounts in a 1981 interview that he had with G. Edward Griffin, he states that the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace opened up their records, their minutes of their meetings. And so wanting to send somebody objective, Norman Dowd has this attorney who Congress agrees with, and this woman says, there's no conspiracy. I could never picture that these establishments, these foundations could ever do anything bad. Then she goes and checks out their records. She reads their records through 50 years of records, and she comes back and she has basically the gist of it. These people were there to subvert your education, your family, everything that you know to be America is something that they think they control and that they can manipulate and they can steal from and they can trick you about your life. And when Norman Dowd lays this out, Norman went to Andover. He's from Yale. He worked for J.P. Morgan. He discovered the fraud. He kind of became a whistleblower. And then he went to work for Congress as a director of research for the Reese Committee. Now, there's very few books out there that even talk about the Reese Committee because of what it found out. And when you show this information to other people, credible people, learned people, people with PhDs after their name, they have to stop and consider it because it wasn't handed to them by their educational system, and it exists, and it's very much real.
Did so much of this get its start with what's referred to as the Tavistock Institute? Can we mention the Tavistock Institute? Because even when I was in college doing media studies, we also went over a guy named Edward Bernays, and and it was on the test that Edward Bernays is the father of modern public relations.
Yeah, totally. Bernays and his other character named Lippmann, basically as a function of Cecil Rhodes' Last Will and Testament, and this isn't a book, it's a 1902 book called The Last Will and Testament of Cecil John Rhodes with elucidatory notes by William T. Stead. And William T. Stead was the executor of Cecil Rhodes' will and was in charge of creating the roundtable groups and these secret societies and the Rhodes scholarships and whatnot. So it's a credible book. I'm going to send you the link after this interview, and you can also look it up on worldcat.com, which will search your local library, but it's usually at a nearby law library, as I found out, for good reason. Tavistock Institute, let me just read you a little foreword out of the book by Dr. James Coleman. It says, or rather it reads, "The Tavistock Institute of Human Relations was unknown to the people of the United States before I exposed its existence in my 1969 monograph, The Tavistock Institute of Human Relations, Britain's Control of the United States. Up to that time, Tavistock had successfully retained its secretive role in shaping the affairs of the United States, its government, and its people since its early beginning in London in 1913 at Wellington House." So, it goes on to say, "Tavistock began as a propaganda creating and disseminating organization centered at Wellington House, where the original organization was put together, with the intent of shaping a propaganda center that would break down a stiff public resistance being encountered to the looming war between Britain and Germany." And so basically what these characters got together and did was, they said, look, they contrived this World War I, they're doing all this crazy financing, they're creating the Federal Reserve around the same time. And then afterwards they said, look, the lies that the war economy has brought us and all the profits and everything that we've gotten because of this, we don't want to give it up. So we have to keep people in the mind that they're always at war, and we have to keep them in the war economy, and we have to build up militaries all over the place, because then we can put them against each other, because the bankers really make money from funding wars and the destruction of the wars. And when they loan people in countries money for war, a lot of times that money can't be paid back, because you can only pay it back with the money that you're being loaned, which is being loaned at interest, which is a recurring loop, which would drive anybody nuts, let alone the people trying to pay compound interest over hundreds of years. But I digress.
But it's well documented that generally throughout most wars, both sides, both enemies, are being funded by essentially these same families and establishments and foundations that we've just spoken about, and ultimately they fund both sides until they decide, we're going to throw a little bit extra money behind these guys. These guys now, are going to win.
Now, I saw a film a couple days ago, and I was in disbelief the whole time I watched it. It's a film produced in 1934 by 20th Century Pictures, before they were 20th Century Fox, in association with United Artists, and the movie was nominated for an Academy Award. It's called The House of Rothschild. It's on YouTube. You can watch it in 12 parts, and it's their propagandized history of their own doings. And even at that, they tell the story much better than any one of us could ever retell their story. I mean, it truly is priceless, and they give it a human angle, because Nathan and his wife, they have such a love story, and before Nathan goes out and fucks everybody, she always gives him a flower to put on his lapel. So there's this love interest, and, you know, they're just a banking family who is being persecuted, and, you know, for even them telling their own story, I just found it incredible how today learned or so-called learned people will deny with every ounce of their being that these bankers control not only our government, but our militaries, our the wars, and that the military is being used to soften the ground to bring in corporations, a la Smedley Butler in his 1934 book, War is a Racket, where he said the only effective way to smash war is to take the profits out of it.
And I believe we could say the same thing about the drug war or any other war on blank.
Well, the only war that has ever existed is the war on consciousness. It's always been a war of people who have more information, a better perspective, a higher perspective, however you want to see it. They have their box is bigger, right? Maybe they have no walls to their box. Maybe they have no limits. Maybe they believe in no God. I'm not sure, but it's always been people who get a hand up, and instead of, you know, lending that hand and trying to help people cooperatively, they always try to wiggle some profit out of it or use it to control and subvert your free will. And so I think where the Darwinists and the evolutionists are wrong is that it's not survival of the fittest and you know, mastering by the most ruthless. It's survival through cooperation, and it's about those of us who can understand the, you know, there's something going on. We can work together to survive and escalate through this situation instead of letting it be our downfall. And I think that's really what, you know, everyone who believes in eugenics and Darwinism and nihilism is missing, is that, you know, when you have things set up in a contrived way like they are now, sure, the most ruthless people are in control, because there are black markets, and anytime you have a black market, the most ruthless people always end up in control. But it doesn't have to be like that if we start cooperating. Our cooperation can outdo their competition anytime. We just have to work together to kind of learn what's going on. And so to subvert that, the planners of Tavistock saw the way to upset the balance of Western civilization was to force unwelcome changes in the race by removing control from deserving and to the undeserving in manner of ancient Roman leaders who were supplanted by their former slaves and aliens. So basically, the way to have us go downhill is to put the least among us in control. Let's put the scoundrels and the schemers and the people who would take corporate lobby money and put those in Congress and have them represent us, right? That's a great idea. I'm sure that's working out really great for everybody.
This kind of makes me think of what, you know, as we're talking about the information, ultimately, is that right now, and we're using the technology to try and communicate this information, we have what's literally the 21st century Gutenberg press. We have more information at our fingertips than has ever been available in the course of human history. And at the same time, it's such a cloud, to make another media reference. It's at the very end of Raiders of the Lost Ark, where they roll that ark into that warehouse, and it goes down the corridor and turns a corner, and you've lost it. The information is there. It exists. It's just being kept from us.
Well, and not only is the information there, but someone like Quigley knew, you know, and noticed and commented upon these such things right before his death. At a lecture at the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University, where he taught for so many years, he said, another thing which may serve to point out the instability of the power system of the state, the individual cannot be made a basic unit of society as we have tried to do, or of the state, since the internalization of controls must be the preponderant influence in any stable society. Now, do you know what that means?
I caught that, you know, this stuff will all work as long as you let us drive.
Right. Well, basically what he's saying throughout this whole thing, because I had to get the dictionary out and start looking up words. I'm like, whoa. And what he's saying is, in our society, individual behavior can no longer be controlled by any system of weaponry we have. In fact, we do not have enough people, even if we equip them with shock weapons, to control the behavior of that part of the population which does not have internalized controls. Now, going back to what I said in the first time, internalized control, that means control by media, that means control by propaganda, it means control by your belief. They can't control all of us through weapons and tasers and things like this. That's why they need you to watch your TV and read their newspaper and believe their shiznit, and not confront people with your own facts and the own things that you've experienced and learned on your own. Because most people out there, if you scratch the surface, they're only as smart as their news channels tell them. And I'm just saying that there is a better way. You can subscribe to a higher awareness, but it takes a little work on your part. You can't just hand over this information and make it work for you until you do your own homework.
These things, I think, have helped us set the table in a way in going over what you refer to as this body of history of all of these things that essentially happened pre-9/11.
Can I just want to give you one more example.
Please,
of
please.
9/11, and then we can go full speed ahead, because I'm itching to get to that too. All right, the last book I want to talk about is called The Old Boys, The American Elite, and the Origins of the CIA. This is a book by Burton Hirsch, and I have had it for probably 6 or 7 years. And the whole time since I've read it, I haven't found facts that either point us in a better direction or describe what was going on the best. Because to summarize the whole book, all the intelligence agencies and all the things that we think, you know, were in charge of World War II and, all, you know, Vietnam and all these things, they are all created by Wall Street bankers. More importantly, these guys did it as a function out of the Versailles Treaty in 1919, where all these international bankers got together, including Alan Dulles and John Foster Dulles, right? And Wild Bill Donovan. Now, the interesting thing about the Dulles brothers, as according to this book, it says Alan Dulles was working in Bern, Switzerland. Well, there's a lot of interesting things that go on in Bern, Switzerland, but what Alan Dulles was doing was helping foreign companies circumvent United States law. So when you get back into, you know, looking into the roots of the intelligence agencies that provided us with all this pseudo information to misdirect us with, that's what a magic wand is for. That's what Hollywood is for, because they made those wands out of Hollywood, right? It's misdirection. It's like, look over here, not at our hand, palming the ball, right? So knowing the nature and the origin of our ruling elite and how the bankers and these Ivy League guys, Wall Street banker types, also Wall Street attorneys, create the CIA, the OSS, along with the Rockefeller Institute, which is founded by funded by CIA money and was, up until recently, always manned by an ex-CIA staffer, right? So looking into these books and better understanding that, well, they do business on basis of deception. They do a lot of misdirection. They do a lot of orgies of evidence so that you have to look over here at all this stupid stuff that would never be left behind in this situation. But there it is. Somebody put it there. Now we got to look at it, right? And understanding the nature of how they've, you know, done psychological warfare and, you know, all the other things that go on, understanding that and then looking at the evidence of 9/11. And it's like, what's indicative of the crime and what was put there for the FBI to find, type of thing. You know what I'm saying?
Well, and I believe it was just a few weeks ago that there was a story about the CIA wants to recruit Wall Street bankers to sort of help them, I assume, watch for money fraud or God knows what. But it was just such an amusing headline to see. It's like, oh, because CIA and Wall Street have never been connected before now.
Well, and Wall Street and the Nazis are directly connected, because here's, you know, the book talking about how Reinhard Gehlen, who is one of Hitler's top men, he was brought back to America and he was taken in by the CIA. And Gehlen himself would subsequently pronounce Dulles, both Dulleses, both fatherly and boisterous. And he would become close personal friends of both of them, right? And so it talks about Reinhard Gehlen and Alan Dulles helping to set up Mossad, helping to set up Israel, right? Because it's coming from British bankers in the background. And so when you go through this book, you catch the name of this guy named Frank Wisner. Now, Frank Wisner was not only instrumental in working with people like General Wild Bill Donovan and C.D. Jackson, who was the owner of the Zapruder film during that time it was missing. He was a head of Time Life, C.D. Jackson. But Wisner, being founder of the CIA and running, he was co-founder, and running this thing called the Mighty Wurlitzer, how America played the CIA through its false media campaigns and propaganda and things like this. Well, Wisner's son is this guy who's on the board of directors of AIG and a company named Kroll Associates. And so when I was reading The Old Boys and I'm reading about the antics and activities of Frank G. Wisner, and then I noticed that his son, Frank G. Wisner Jr., is on the AIG SEC filings. He's on Kroll's SEC filings. And Kroll and AIG are instrumental in 9/11, not only its planning and perpetration and benefiting from that exact situation, but also the hundreds of billions of dollars they stole post 9/11, just recently. And, you know, if more people had picked up on Project Constellation 3 years ago, more media personalities who, you know, have large audiences and supposedly have a responsibility to share this type of information, a lot of people could have saved the money that they lost through this whole scheme. Because at the end of the day, we had this information, we wanted to get it to you, but we had to learn to make media ourselves in order to be able to get it out there. Because other than Maria, nobody else that I know of really played Project Constellation for their audience, except maybe yourself.
Only later, when I started the radio show, I think did I play pieces of it. I definitely passed it off to other people who were skeptical of being critical of the story of 9/11. I would basically hand it to people and say, now listen to this. This will really break things down in a way that kind of gives you the big picture. The beginning.
Well, I was trying to. Well, I was trying to connect some dots and make a big picture, but you know, back then I wasn't as articulate or as fear-free as I am now. I'm a lot better, oriented to the situation, understand it for what it is, and have absolutely no fear, because you know, not only have I had personal experiences, but I've had realizations that have let me know that, you know, fear is just the training wheels that this world puts on you to move forward. And once you realize what fear is for, and you realize you don't need fear in your thinking, and you let that fear go on the wayside and don't use it, then you'll notice that your actions start to reflect your will. And then you're going to start to manifest daily events that are more in tune with where you're trying to be happiness-wise. So I can't see anything else, you know, going on than, you know, this evolution based on cooperation and each of us trying to do our own, you know, our looking around, and then have the responsibility to ask respectful questions and listen to what people have to say.
Well, and that's, I think, ultimately what I'm trying to do here right now.
It is what we are doing right now.
There is no try. I believe a puppet once said, Yoda. So, and as I'm chomping at the bit to get to talking about the official story.
Let's talk about it.
You began Project Constellation, which again, we referenced at the beginning of this interview, which was your initial message in a bottle. It was your your transmission to the world to get out what you had seen. You started off with an analogy about chess. Could you repeat that for us here?
Well,
or paraphrase it.
Well, I want to give you the gist of it. I saw in my research, I was on YouTube and I saw this like a magician, like an illusionist type of person, right? Kind of like Chris Angel, but without all the kookiness. And this dude's name was Darren Brown, and he had a bunch of different little segments. And I was watching this, and I was in awe because he was using words. He was using something I came to read was called neuro-linguistic programming, which is basically taking your mind, which is a computer, and feeding certain words into it so you do certain things. And he would go out and pay for things with like blank money, or he would go up to somebody and basically have them hold a bottle, which is their acceptance of his code, and then he'd say these words and they would turn over their wallet and their cell phone and all this stuff. Well, in the one video, he sits down and he plays 8 grandmaster chess guys all at the same time, and it was just so mesmerizing. I was like, how's he doing this? And at the end, what's cool is he shows you how he did it. And I was like, wow, now that you know that, anyone can do this, right? And so the thing was, I was trying to lay out this incredible situation. It's like, you know, would you bet against me? Well, you might bet against me until you knew that I knew this trick and I'm going to win, and then that would change what you do, right? So basically laying out that your choices are limited to the information that you have available at any given time. And if you don't have a piece of information available at a certain time, it may cost you a lot of money, because when you realize it later, you said, oh, I wish I would have had that. I wish I would have known that I didn't know. And I wish I would have paid attention. So I was trying to open people's mind up and basically like, look, you need to stop thinking you know for a couple minutes. Let me unsuspend your disbelief. You know, let me have you think critically about what's being said and what my intentions are. Am I out there trying to get famous? No, I don't think, you know, this is about my story at all. I just happen to be there and then have the fortitude and take the, you know, initiative to do what I knew needed to be done. And I wasn't going to wait for anyone else to do it, let alone try to do it better than I could do it, because strategically focused on this situation, I think I can do it as better, you know, as good as anyone else can do it, if not better, because I have the motivation of having, you know, personally lost people I worked with on 9/11. There was like 320 people that I worked with that died. So I do have a personal stake in understanding what happened that day.
So the poker masters, the trick is, and what Darren Brown did was he was essentially writing down the moves of the first player and using those against the third player. He was essentially playing them against each other. That,
yeah,
for
so
me,
you mirror their strongest, you know, you mirror the strongest opponents against each other. You let them fight it out, and you're going around taking everyone's money. And in that analogy is how they control us. That's how
Absolutely.
The world is run. That is how the gangsters do it. It's not that they are like big, hulking, steroid, scary monsters. They're just people with information and bad intentions, and they just don't have the, you know, the wherewithal or the love within them or the compassion or the empathy to get this information to people who are being, you know, adversely affected by it, whether it's people being poisoned by prescription drugs, you know, because they have got these lawyers and all this stuff. And it's like, if it doesn't kill a certain amount of people, then we're going to go ahead and release it. Or if it's banned in this country, Bayer, go ahead and sell the AIDS-infected vaccines overseas to other people who are too dumb to say no. And I can't stand by and try to earn a paycheck and go back to driving a Porsche and a Range Rover and forget. I can't unknow all this stuff. I'm not willing to unsee it. And unless I do something with it, then it's going to eat a hole inside of me. So it doesn't matter if someone tries to shoot a hole in me. At least it's because I'm doing what I want. I'm trying to be free, and my freedom exists because I'm trying to make you free.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
It's cognitive liberty. We each seek to be free in mind, because if they can't control our mind, then they can never control our bodies.
I think this is the precipice that people who do start to look into this information, perhaps at the insistence of folks like us, they'll reach a point where they'll perhaps shut down or turn off or not go any further, because within their belly, they know that once you learn this information, just as you said, you can't unlearn it unless you make that somewhat conscious decision to do it, but I think people don't have to. They stop.
Well,
they don't want to find it out, because then they would have to do something with it.
What would be the logical, reasonable, you know, intellectually responsible way of unlearning reality? I mean, what you're doing is you're unlearning your illusion, but the illusion wasn't real. Reality is something you want to get in touch with. And people have fear and they shut down, and, you know, that's fine, but recognize that you're doing that, right? And you fear because you don't understand. And people are able to hate because they fear. So if people hate because they fear and they fear because they don't understand, then reading and learning and doing and communicating and taking in some healthy non-corporate media, turning off your TV, canceling your newspaper, and giving your money to people who won't lie to you or aren't lying to you or at least doing their best to get the right facts in front of you. I mean, there has to be a moment where when you discern that a lot of your trouble is coming because you are funding every month the people who are taking away your freedom to have fresh water, to have clean air, to have fresh food and clothing, to have health care, all of these things, right? But if we can just learn our way out of hating, if we can learn our way out of instantly emotionally dehumanizing people because the media told us that Osama bin Laden attacked us, well, Dick Cheney said Osama had nothing to do with 9/11. The FBI is not looking for him. So who are we supposed to trust? I say don't trust any of those people until they do something trustworthy, right? And when I look at somebody like, Senator Barry Goldwater in his autobiography, With No Apologies, which is a very apropos title, in chapter 33 titled, our non-elected leaders, he's talking about how these characters, the bankers, took over the Federal Reserve, created the Federal Reserve, rather, took over our rights. And he says, in my view, the Trilateral Commission represents a skillful, coordinated effort to seize control and consolidate the four centers of power, political, monetary, intellectual, and ecclesiastical. All this is to be done in the interest of creating a more peaceful, more productive world community. Throughout my public life and in these pages, I have refrained from judging other men's motives. I have no such hesitancy about judging their wisdom and the results of the actions taken. Right? So he goes, trilateral, here's their approach. So these aren't things that conspiracy theorists creatively made up. Believe me, none of us are this creative. They're the books. They're in the libraries. They're all over the place, and people are trying to burn them. Most of the books I end up getting are like rejected from the library, discard. And they're the most valuable books because they lead us back to the freedom we once thought we had. Now, we may not have it now, but we have a roadmap in front of us. We have an opportunity to participate with other people who are looking to do the same thing. So, you know, I'm not trying to push anyone to subscribe to the magazine or anything that we're doing, but we're not doing it for the money. We're doing it because it's what we wish somebody else would have done for us. I wish I could just pay $15 a month and get access to the information that I have to work harder now than I ever did at a corporation. So... that's where I'm at.
Well,
with that,
and as I referenced before, saying that, you know, people may turn off and turn away from this kind of information, I don't also want to imply that anybody who doesn't look into 9/11 is just scared because you can't handle the truth. I think there are also
I would say look into everything except 9/11. I mean, if you're having problems digesting that people might prey on us as people, as other human beings might prey on us in some way. I mean, if you're having trouble digesting that, then read any other segment of U.S. history that, you know, because it's all there. It's not just 9/11. What I was trying to explain is there is like, you know, 10 or 20 significant actions that have taken place during the 20th century, which allowed 9/11 to be successfully planned, perpetrated, and profited from, and let these people get away scot-free with billions and billions of dollars and fake insurance claims because they all funded and, you know, basically circle jerked each other in those deals. They're all the same people insuring each other's stuff, and they all know it's fake, and they're investigating themselves. I mean, there has not been any legitimate investigation, and very few of the so-called little blips on the radar screen, intelligence knew ahead of time, that sort of stuff. Very little of that's actually real. Most of it's misdirection, so you never go after the real people who are continuing to do this to you. So it just wasn't one day 8 years ago. It's, you know, the effects and ramifications and consequences are more evident today by the state of our economy than they were on September 12th.
So I guess we'll hit it point blank then, if I can. Why do people believe the official story of 9/11?
Well, that's a good question. There's a lack of historical perspective. Right. So kind of what we're doing herein by trying to give you these references in these books is inoculating you with information. It's a vaccination of information so that you can be coherent. You can have the context. You can have the history and facts at your disposal, and you can articulate them in such a way that someone else can consume them and make them part of their understanding. Right. So the reason that people believe the official story, well, media in and of itself gives you a selective view. They give you a repetitive view, which is, you know, one of the things that Pavlovian conditioning would have you do, right? So these are Tavistockian ideas, if you will, right? On top of that, the media has completely owned those companies that you look for every day that you think are your trusted friend in the news world on TV with three letters, you know? Those were all created by the people who look at you as sheep, and they are the shepherds, and you are not the same as them, and basically you are animals to them, which is why they talk about, you know, Ted Turner talks about taking out 90% of the population. So just the rich people and their jets and their private islands, and everyone can, you know, exist. And I just happen to disagree with that. I'm not angry with them. I don't hate them. I just happen to disagree intellectually with that. And I think I can say some words that might help to change it in our favor, right? The other part is the government. The government gives you a selective view, and they're not known for their integrity or their trustability, right? In the past, there's been countless false flags, whether it's the Lusitania or the Spanish-American War or the Gulf of Tonkin or all these things that have now come out, declassified documents. They were all started for money.
A few weeks ago, we had President Obama speaking, I believe, in Cairo. It was his Cairo speech where not only did he essentially echo George W. Bush's speech to let us never tolerate outrageous conspiracy theories concerning the events of September 11th, but he acknowledged what we referred to earlier as Operation Ajax. And this is the known CIA operation to overthrow the democratically elected leader of Iran in 1953.
Kermit Roosevelt
wrote all about it. So he acknowledged Operation Ajax. So it's this sort of, you know, selective sight on things that, oh, well, yes, this happened, but these other things didn't.
Operation Gladio. There's a book called NATO's Secret Armies. And, you know, all of these things. I mean, when you look at the history of false flag operations, they go back for thousands of years. When you look at Art of War, when you look at Machiavelli's work on the Medici family and how they maintained and attained power, you know, it's all right there in front of us. But like Alan Dulles says, that, you know, the public doesn't read. So we're going to make, you know, his group was going to remain in control until we started doing our homework and, you know, not just listening to Vincent Bugliosi tell us it was Oswald with a single, you know, magic bullet. Because Oswald can't make the Secret Service stand down that day. Oswald can't, you know, control C.D. Jackson owning the Zapruder film and editing it, provably, right? So these different things help to block people's view. It creates that blind spot because you have a trusting relationship with a corporation, which is actually a sociopath. So you should look at yourself. Why are you trusting sociopaths to print your money, to educate your kids, to feed your families, to provide services that you could be providing to yourself? And ask yourself why you're paying all these tax dollars, not to the Federal Reserve, but to the private international bankers who were not elected. This is what Barry Goldwater is talking about with our non-elected leaders. And the next step would be, you know, the third one, you know, media, government, and then religion. Are we a Christian nation? Are we an evangelical nation? I don't know. How many of the founding fathers represented Christianity and not some secret society, right? So we have these ideas in our head because of media, because there's a group of 50 million Christians out there, and they're led by Ted Haggard, right? That's his name, right? Ted Haggard?
Yep. You know, among all the others.
Yeah, right. So you've got these characters who are living, you know, hypocritical lives, lying to millions and millions of people, getting them to back a war against people who are, you know, just on the other side of the world trying to live their lives just like us, right? So shepherds don't lead the people, man. Shepherds lead sheep. So that's why James and myself are more of a, hey, I will think for myself, and if you're thinking for yourself too, I think that's safe to work around you, and I'll work with you, and I'll cooperate with you, and I would want you to walk right beside me, but I don't want anyone following me, and I don't really want to follow any of these other pseudo-leaders, because I see the short-sightedness of what they're doing. I see the limitations to their game. I see where they're doing a limited hangout and trying to be gatekeepers, trying to be catchers in the rye and keep people from going over the cliff of truth and figuring out, hey, that what they're doing, they're controlling everybody through an illusion, right? So those are the reasons that people believe the official story. They, you know, those are the, you know, the ballpark reasons. Everyone can have a different, you know, little micro reason, but those
cover the pretty main areas. Those three: government, media, and religion.
Sure. And then it's like the other thing that's in their blind spot is this. Like, you know, what is the root cause of 9/11? Was it money? Was it power? I would assert that it's control. It's control over your mind, your body, your fear mechanism, right? And you just have to understand that there's a group of people who are operating on this planet who have an operating system or a belief system that mandates that, you know, they are chosen to control you. and that you're not mandated, you know, you're not controlling them. They're there to control you. You don't have free choice. Schwarzenegger's made comments about this. Winston Churchill's made comments about this. They are there to tell us what to do, because otherwise we would never know what to do with this beautiful planet and all these resources, right? So they have to make everything artificially scarce. They have to have us not on a sustainable, you know, solution for energy like hemp. They have to have it on something that they can patent and process and control, like oil, because oil gives you a great excuse to go around and collect everyone's land, right? But we don't need to be on oil. But these skull and bones
guys...
patents on cracking the petroleum and making it into fuel, and it allows them to monopolize. And taking hemp out of the market allows DuPont to produce nylon and all these toxic chemicals, right? And so by taking a natural predator out of their industry like hemp, which you can't patent, and it solves their pharmaceutical problems, it solves energy problems, solves food and clothing problems. It's the most nutritious seed on the planet. It used to be mandated to grow hemp in this country. I mean, we saw this great movie a couple weeks ago called The Union. It's probably the best documentary on the history of hemp and why it's illegal and why it's probably going to stay illegal, because too many people profit in our government from it being illegal, like the pharmaceutical shareholders, the medical industrial complex, the industrial complex for the military, like DuPont, with, you know, traditional arms maker and whatnot. Those companies cannot exist in an economy where hemp is legalized.
So that film actually is currently on my Netflix queue way down at the bottom. So I'm glad to actually to hear you mention that. So I'll bump it up. The Union.
Put it up to the top. I've been waiting for a week to get it on DVD. I saw it online. You can see it for free on Google Video. Type in The Union. It's called The Union, The Business of Getting High. It's also on the tragedyandhope.com community site. If you want a two-week register for the magazine, it's in there. You can watch it. Check it out. I guess when you come back to it, the root cause is that these people have this, they want to control us. They have this belief system, right? And that we're not in their group. We're not in their club, as George Carlin would say, right? It's the club that they beat us on the head with. So the idea is that once you recognize, well, some people got here first, they're well-informed, they're using their information against us. All right, cool. They're preying on us. That's not so cool, but, you know, we're dealing with it. We're waking up to it. And so what do? You organize yourself. You inform yourself. You start letting the other neighborhoods and communities know, hey, we've got these group of bandits. They're coming in. They're preying with everybody. They're getting us to use their money. We don't know about money, so we're using theirs, right? It's just always been here since we got here, so it's, like, ubiquitous to our culture. But, you know, Lincoln printed the greenbacks. Anytime that, you know, you want to take your money back, it's there. You have the ability to print your own money.
Well, and there are three presidents who attempted to sort of, you know, regain control over the money, and that's Jackson, Lincoln, and Kennedy, and we know what happened to all three of them.
Right, so it really does come back to the international bankers, because all the intelligence agencies, all the FBIs, CIAs, all these things work for the international bankers. Watch your James Bond movies again closely. Ian Fleming worked for MI6. MI6 has been around since the 1400s. It came out of Kabbalistic magician John Dee's bag of tricks, and the Empire has found subversion and diversion through misdirection and magic very useful to intelligence gathering efforts. So when you watch James Bond again, know that they're really out there working for bankers, and that the bankers are paying not just both sides, but all three sides. Because in the case of Kuhn Loeb and Warburg and these other characters like J.P. Morgan, the Harriman families and whatnot, hey, they funded Germany. They funded the Bolshevik Revolution. They funded Wall Street and FDR and all this stuff from Wall Street. So they're controlling two or three sides at a time and always benefiting from it. So I only say, look, we can't continue to do the same thing over and over again and get an expected different result, right? We can only solve these problems by growing bigger than they are and expanding our awareness, because you can't solve problems at the same level of consciousness that created them, right? Which, you know, that's an Einstein quote. He's telling us we have to go learn. We have to expand our boundaries. We have to expand our consciousness to be able to see the big picture, because the people who we're playing against have a much bigger picture. It's like, why is there no banker on the chessboard? I should have asked that in Project Constellation, and the answer would be, well, the banker moves all the pieces.
He doesn't need to be on the board or on the grand chessboard,
Yeah, it's their board.
This, I just thought of something wrong. You know, this, the doing the same thing over and over again and respecting, you know, expecting different results is the definition of insanity. So as we've looked through all these things, and perhaps we were able to kind of shake free of these sort of government controls and the media controls and the religion controls, that there are many, 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 many people who question the events and the media descriptions and the myths that surround 9/11. What makes me do this to this day? I would admit on some level I was probably traumatized by the events of 9/11 and need some kind of closure or exposure in a way to try and make sense of all this.
Well, it's not just about that day. You're trying to make sense of the world outside of these walls and these doors in whatever room we're in right now. It's like what goes on out there didn't just happen in one day, and it didn't just go away in one day. And there's a larger set of dynamics going on. And yeah, it can be overwhelming. And we definitely, anyone who saw 9/11 either on TV or in person has some form of PTSD. You just saw a large number of life get snuffed out. You saw people committing suicide, jumping out of the windows to save themselves from the flames. You see all this going on. You see how tragic it is. You see all the victims' families. They're pulling at your heartstrings through the media. The media is pulling your heartstrings by purposely presenting these things in overly dramatic ways when they know that they're not doing a real investigation, right? So I just disapprove of the hypocrisy, and I think that, you know, the victims' families deserve more than that. I think the people who have looked into 9/11 truth to any degree, looking into something other than the official story being 9/11 truth, I think, yeah, everyone has been traumatized because PTSD is a normal reaction to an abnormal situation. So what you have is 300 million people who are normal, everyday people for the most part, going through a traumatic situation on the news being shown to them thousands of times, so much that you can't even see it anymore. You can't even see it. And so, you know, for someone who researches to take the videos apart frame by frame and look at what they actually showed us that day, and then to understand the levels of calibration and collaboration that they can do with the video systems that they hold and the things that they can make happen with TV and controlling people like puppets through television and music, in their newscasts and whatnot. Why is there music in news? I ask you that. Why do they have music in their newscasts? Because they're controlling your emotions the whole time. They are manipulating your emotions. And so I say I only listen to media from people I know and respect because I know that they're not going to mistreat me. I know that their intentions are true. And I know it's not going to be anything toxic for me or my spirit.
Right? Well, because just as you mentioned that, I was like, well, I always put music under my news. But
no, I love that, by the way.
It was something I learned. It was something I learned.
I might interrupt you.
No, go ahead. Sorry.
If I might interrupt you for a second, I think the music in your podcast is fantastic because you take information that otherwise couldn't be consumed by people, because that's what I thought. It's like I started doing it in my podcast a bit because I was like, look, it's like knowing that the human body needs minerals and vitamins and going out and scraping these up out of the ground and be like, here's some vitamin C, here's some calcium, eat this. You're like, no, I can't eat that. Those are rocks. Right? And we need to create food. We need to create nutritious media, the sustenance that comes in through our eyes and our ears and through our hearts. Because this is the only way we can start to heal ourselves from this post-traumatic stress disorder of the war on terror that keeps on going and we have no idea who we're chasing. I mean, it's like Emmanuel Goldstein from 1984, but I digress. The point would be that, you know, it's up to us. We can either feel like the world's gone crazy, or we could say the world, yeah, it was crazy until I started paying attention to it, and now we're making more sense out of it every day. And sooner than later, we're going to understand the user manual first, you know, planet Earth, and know how to deal with these other entities that prey on us for their living, because they're not creative enough to make a living without preying on you and stealing your energy unwittingly. I just don't think it's fair.
Well, and I think
so that's why we do it, you know, what we do. And that's why you put the music under there, so people can get the vibe and they can take in the information and they can start to feel it and they can start to make it part of their bodies. And that makes change in their actions, because just the littlest thought can make the biggest change, right? And so I think it's a beautiful thing, and I've wanted to say that for a long time, that one of the favorite things in your podcast, aside from the awesome information and the crisp delivery, is that you keep the mood positive underneath, and you keep pushing people forward and saying, look, it's hard, but we got some music, so let's roll.
I think I definitely chalk that up and thank it to, you know, more of my background in radio and theater. I did a lot of.
You have a degree in media production, right?
I do. I had a lot of time spent at WSHC, a non-commercial 950-watt FM radio station at my college at Shepherd University in Shepherdstown, West Virginia. And I did so much airtime there that I realized at some point it was like, oh, when I'm on the air, perhaps thinking of the next thing I'm going to say, if I have a little music bed underneath me, I don't get nervous and feel like, oh, there's dead air, I have to fill it with going, yeah, you know. And it sort of was a nice little glue and a nice thing that I could glide along, and it could help pace me out and not go too slow or not go too fast. The other thing is that I minored in theater with an emphasis on sound design. So doing sound effects and music and the in-between parts when you do a blackout and a scene change, I think I took a lot of that experience and knowledge and flipped it around a little bit and said, well, okay, we're not going to be playing, you know, punk rock 7 inches. We're going to be talking about what's really going down in the world. Perhaps we'll open the show with a punk rock 7-inch, but it's, again, there to make, you know, the information accessible.
Well, totally, man, because if it's not accessible, then, you know, what are we doing out there? That's why I'm so particular about, I like to be prepared to make sure that I'm respecting someone else's time who's taking the time to give me the benefit of the doubt, to listen to the words I have to say, and to see whether I'm trying to empower them or if I'm trying to be sly and take something from them. You know what I'm saying? And so when I bring it back, it's like, just to communicate that which I had experienced as a whistleblower, you have to learn how to create media. You have to learn, you know, I had to learn cinematography, because if you don't have at least as good a production value as the infomercial that people see in the middle of the night, then they're not going to listen to you. Even though you have information that's 100 times more pertinent to their survival than the infomercial, they will watch the infomercial and zone out and just go with the program because it's professionally produced. It has quality sound. It has good camera angles and good lighting, you know, and it has a format that they're comfortable with. And so what I tried to do with 9/11 Synchronicity was purposely break all the formats, break everything that, you know, culture had said. And I said, I want to see who can follow me down this path, because the people who come out on the other end of this podcast are going to be educated. They're going to be active. They're going to have taken the initiative. And I work with a lot of the people that have made it through that whole podcast, because it's more of a homing beacon for people who are kind of tuned in and have long attention spans. Because if you can make it through a 14-hour podcast, then you have the attention span necessary to look at some of these larger pieces of information that make everything else make sense. I mean, there's keystone pieces of information out there, but it's no good to people who can't turn that key, you know, with their mind. You got to understand these things. And there's something for doing things with the information as opposed to just hearing it on the radio in between Berkey water cooler ads. Just me.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think,
or it's like, I would mention that it's like every time in the past that I had done an interview on one of the stations that does commercials every couple minutes, I felt like they were getting me on there just to get people to listen to the commercials. And it's like, before I had time to make a coherent thought, oh, again, we got to listen to this
fear-mongering
commercial. And I'm like, when we designed Tragedy and Hope, we said, look, what's the critical flaw to all this corporate media? And well, it's the advertisers and the profits that come from that. It's like, all right, so let's take those out of the equation. What do we have now? Oh, now we have something that actually performs as designed and serves its purpose. And then that's something that, you know, is good, because you can put out the video, the audio, and the text that people need, because it's not just about reading a book. It's, you got to read this book, and then you got to watch The Hidden Agenda with Norman Dodd, which is a DVD, and then you got to read this other text and watch this other video from YouTube, and this helps you fill in the blanks, because there's no official history on this yet. There's only the pieces they've left us behind and the pieces we can fill in to get this picture, and, you know. So
picking up the loose change, if you will. Sorry, I had to say
following the money, picking up the loose change. That's what it's all about. You know, those people have so much money. The people who are doing this have so much money that they left loose change all over the place. And if you just follow the money, it leads you back to these corporations, back to these intelligence agencies that are created by these international bankers who have been ruling over us unwittingly, you know, for us unwittingly for 100 years at least. But, you know, in the current form, 100 years. So none of this is new. When I showed some of this information, like the Hidden Agenda, Norman Dodd, to my dad, I said, look, here's what's going on. These foundations had been influencing our education system. This explains why people don't realize and people think they know, and the history they've learned is not necessarily accurate. And he said he understood that it had been going on, but tracing it all the way back to 1901 credibly through this Hidden Agenda DVD, he's like, I didn't realize it was going on for 100 years. I knew something was going wrong, but, you know. And so even just sharing it with friends and family, they are now able to open their eyes, and it's not too bright. You know, it's not so bright that they have to close their eyes again, using the allegory of the cave metaphor. People are now starting, you know, to be more in tune, because I think that's what a lot of people can't communicate. We're communicating at this frequency of fear if we're listening to the radio and those ads, and we're like, you got to listen, you got to listen. And these other people who are in corporate matrix land, they're on this other vibration. And so we were trying to design in Tragedy and Hope was the practical application to bridge these two vibrations, to take people out of that fear mode and into a comfortable place where they can, you know, articulate these facts and pieces of data succinctly and communicate with people, because that's what corporations benefit from, us not communicating. The whole world is controlled, basically, because we haven't communicated the answers we have among all of us, right? So, you know, we're kind of back at the beginning. If you look at the history of conspiracy that people don't, you know, believe, you got Machiavelli's and the Medici's and the origins of central banking and whatnot. If you take away corporate personhood, then you don't have these magnates who are able to finance, you know, communism, the Cold War, Hitler, the war on terror, all of this stuff, right? If you take away Tavistock, then you don't have these people controlling every piece of media that you've been exposed to your whole life for the most part, right? And if you look at who benefits from something like 9/11, you're seeing that Kroll and AIG and companies like this participate. And then AIG's actions with all these bailouts, you know what that's doing? It's ruining the credit of the securities derivatives and the subprime loans, right? It ruined the credit rating. So Kroll is now coming out with a new credit rating firm. So they create these disasters to give you these solutions that otherwise you would say, I don't need that. But
so,
hey.
There it is. You know? That's the what's Hegelian referred to dialectic. As the Hegelian dialectic, problem, reaction, solution. These gangsters, banksters create the problems to get the reaction out of us so that they then have the political and social capital to offer their solution that was already written and was sitting on the shelf and was waiting for the catalyzing catastrophic event to be able to pass it.
Exactly. Couldn't put it better myself.
Let's actually, and I don't know if you need a break or anything else, but I would like to hear, you know, a capsule, you know, because it's kind of difficult to understand sometimes, the financial situation that you saw pre 9/11. Ultimately, you know, the devil's advocate thing of being like, well, what do you know about 9/11? Why should I listen to you?
All right. Well, I worked in the World Trade Center. The office, like I said, was on the 96th floor, and being there that day, I have personal experiences. Now, I don't want anyone to take my personal experiences and try to go around and convince people about 9/11, because the personal experiences, you know, you need some experience to understand what was going on. You have financial services companies that are seeking to take people out of the process, because they used to do things on things called paper. And so people write up a contract, they'd write up a bid, they'd write up a proposal, they'd write up a money transfer on paper, and there were papers and filing cabinets, and these things could be used as evidence in cases. And a financial services company said, hey, wouldn't it be great if we took like these 500 jobs here and we got rid of those jobs, and instead we just put all those papers, we just scan them in, so we'll hire one person who scans in these documents, and they save a lot of money, not only in manpower, but now with the computer they can set up these automated systems using the software we're designing, and they can transfer money all over the place without any prying eyes looking to see if, you know, this is legitimate trading or legitimate securities. It's actually what caused the entire bubble that's ravaged the financial economy over the past 2 years. It was all preventable. It was all pre-planned by people who know your financial systems much better than you. They have control over the systems that watchdog over your financial systems and the stock market and whatnot. That's how they're able to do the insider trading ahead of time. It's how they're able to steal, in the case of AIG and Marsh, hundreds of billions of dollars from their clients and from, you know, the government, which ultimately got the money from hardworking, you know, people living here in America trying to raise families and live their lives. So when our wealth is so easily transferred to these gangbankers who get paid out in these huge bonuses, and oh, by the way, the people who got the bonuses from AIG are part of the real ownership, which is why they don't want you to know who got the bonuses, right? Going back to that, it's like, from my perspective, I was blinded by the money, because when you're getting paid $90,000 or $100,000 a month sometimes, you tend to not question a whole lot because you're busy spending your money and you don't have any financial incentive to question anything. In my case, I had gotten a paycheck that was significantly lower than the records indicated it should be. So when I questioned the records that I had from the client to the records my company was using, I noticed a huge discrepancy in the money. Like my company was transferring a whole lot more money than they were going to pay me commission on. And as a salesperson, that's how my livelihood works, I was concerned about my commission check. So all I did, I mean, I wasn't trying to play a superhero or bring down a system or, you know, anything.
You said, hey, you're trying to screw me.
And since my whole team at the company, there was like three or four people under me, so they also got paid based on what my sales are. So I wrote an email to my team saying, hey, look, our paychecks are going to be less than we thought they were from our documents, right? And let's have a meeting on this tomorrow morning when I get into the office. Let's do it at 9 a.m. and we'll just talk about this. And if, and, you know, basically I was thinking if anyone on the team had overextended themselves and they needed, you know, me to loan them some money for the month or whatever was going to happen, because that happened from time to time. People outspend themselves when you have so much money coming in. It's just ludicrous land, right? So I go into the office, and before I can even get to my office, I'm told to go into my boss's office. I walk in the door. This dude, you know, behind me shuts the door. He was hiding behind the door. His name's John Judge. He lives up in Massachusetts. He worked for Silverstream Software. And he says, "Rich, today is not your lucky day. We're letting you go." And so I sit down. I'm beside myself because I just closed a deal the day before that's getting me $1 million commission check. So I'm having a little bit of an issue with this. And I say, "Look, you know, is it, you know, what's the problem? Is it with the client? What's going on?" And they just basically tell me they want my commission check. They think they can keep the account open without me there. I'm no longer necessary type thing. And the guy who fires me wants to take the check. I was like, all right, not a whole lot I could do. So fast forward, I tried to, you know, spend a bunch of money all summer and forget about it. And I end up in a situation in late August of 2001 where I had just been in the hospital with and had to have an emergency surgery. My gallbladder had like blown up and it was just crazy emergency circumstance. I'm in a hospital and my health insurance is about to run out. Lo and behold, here comes the CFO, the chief financial officer of Silverstream, which was a publicly traded company. And he says, "Look, Rich, we want to extend your health care benefits and we want to give you $9,999, not to talk about anything you did for Marsha McLennan." I was like, all right. And I took the money because I was so dumb. I was like, yeah, whatever. I need the health care benefits right now. I still have stitches, all, you know. And basically, they used fear to get me to participate in this contract. Well, then after a couple days, I thought, well, nobody gives you that much money for nothing. And it's kind of a weird amount. And then, you know, it had dawned on me that they use that amount because then it's not reported to the SEC or the board of directors. And if it was $1 more, it would have had to go on their records, right? So they're trying to keep it below the radar. So I'm like, well, I'm out of working for them. I don't communicate with people from Marsh really anymore. But being that their jobs are on the line, that the software is going to remove their jobs, the necessity for them being there, their livelihoods, their careers, their families, I was like, I should reach out and give some of these documents over to some people there that I trust. So I called his number and I left a message for the receptionist of Catherine Lee. And you can look her up on the internet. She was an IT manager at Marsh & McLennan. And I got a message back the next day directing me to drop the documents that I had off at this meeting, a manager's meeting that was going on the next morning. So if you look on the internet, there's Ellen Clark, who is the chief information officer, the global chief information officer. She had her employees in the office early on the 96th and 97th floors of World Trade Center 1, North Tower. She made sure that they were on the phone, on a conference call, in the office, while she was out of the office. I think she was in London, safe in London. And she was on the phone with her people when the explosion went off in the North Tower on the 96th floor at Marsh's headquarters. Or not their headquarters, but their significant office of 320 people in the World Trade Center, their IT center. The meeting that I was supposed to go to was a separate meeting. It was being run by a man named Michael Darvish, D-A-R-V-I-C-H-E, and who's, by the way, in a business now with a member of Council on Foreign Relations. But I digress. Darvish was having this meeting. He had all his people in the office on a conference call, and he sat in his Upper West Side apartment while the conference call buzzed out and clicked off. So I was sitting in traffic. I was in a convertible. I had the top down. I've got this blue folder next to me of these documents, and I'm supposed to deliver them up to the 96th floor between 9 and 9:15, but there was supposed to be a break in the morning meeting, and I was supposed to just kind of come in, drop them off during a break, and leave. And after that, I was planning on going to the beach. My buddy in New Jersey had a beach house, and it was like the last weekend. So I'm in shorts. I'm in a Hawaiian shirt. I'm in traffic a couple blocks from the World Trade Center, and I don't hear anything fly over me. I don't hear any screeching plane. I don't hear any explosion. I'm, you know, a couple blocks away, and I look up, and it's just black smoke coming out of, you can't even see the hole in the building yet. So all I see is black smoke coming out of a place where I'm about to go, and I have a lot of friends that work up there. And I'm looking at this, and I'm trying to understand it, and I turn on the radio in the car because I was listening to a CD. And they say, you know, a helicopter is hit, and that kind of made sense because I thought maybe a helicopter could blow into it because working the Trade Center, you could look down from your office and see helicopters flying below you at 900 feet. And, you know, then they said it was a Cessna on the radio. I thought, well, it's a little harder to fly a Cessna and get blown into a building, but okay, maybe that happened. And at one point, you know, after like 10 minutes or so, some of the cars in front of me were turning around and going back up West Side Highway. I made this left onto a street called, I believe it's called Vizzy Street, and I was between World Trade Center 7 and World Trade Center 6. World Trade Center 7 was on my left, World Trade Center 6 was on my right, and at the moment that the explosion happens in the South Tower, I notice, boom, 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 like flash, 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 in World Trade Center 6 at near ground level, and I know that these two simultaneous events cannot be independent of each other. They must be related to each other. And for such big explosions, I then knew, my subconscious said, you don't know what's going on in this situation. You must remove your person from this area right now. At which time I took off and I went up this one-way street the wrong way. I went through the Holland Tunnel. I drove into New Jersey and as fast as I could down to my friend's place who I went to high school with. I go in, I wake him up. I'm like, look, you got to turn on the TV. There's crazy shit going on, dude. He gets up, we look at it, and, you know, what they were showing on TV, even, you know, 40 minutes later when I was in New Jersey, was not reflective of the spirit or the mood or what was going on at Ground Zero. So already that morning, they were showing things in a different perspective, in a different light, with different angles than what was going on down there. And there's so many questions and there's so many pieces of evidence that contradict what the official story is. And there's so many pieces of evidence that they've put out there that they've taken it away or they won't let you look at it. And it's like, if that's really what happened, why do they have to hide so much of it from us, right? And it's like, it's those questions based on that experience that make you ask. Now, Marsh and McLennan, again, my client, was they had stock put options placed on them the week before. They were, you know, 61 times the normal bid rate. Marsh and McLennan was, a great business at the time, like, financially, according to the market, they had no risk. They were the number one in their market space, right? So why would somebody be betting against it so vehemently? And at the same time, betting against American Airlines, which coincidentally seemed to intersect on 9/11, right? And more importantly, how did Arab hijackers do that? I'm not saying they're not capable or they're not smart. I'm just saying they do not have the organizational ability, given the facts that Al-Qaeda is the name of a file, according to Robin Cook. It's the name of a file, in a database of these guys who they used to pay for Mujahideen. And I had said that in 2006 in Project Constellation. I laid all of this out for people. And yet to this day, I think yourself and myself and Maria and a handful of other people have been able to grasp that information and to make it useful.
Now, when, you know, friends of mine, family of mine, you know, who will sometimes jokingly say, oh, hi, you know, you and that conspiracy stuff. I thought maybe we might need to have an intervention or something. Ha, ha, ha. What is it for them, you think, that makes them sort of resist it? And the questions always come, just like, well, why would they do that? If it was a conspiracy, it would take thousands of people, and it would have come out by now. They're all inept. George Bush couldn't hide WMD in Iraq. How on earth would he blow up the World Trade Center?
Well, I'm not saying George Bush had anything to do with
I've never said that
the
either.
World Trade Center. He's just an actor who is paid by the same production company that put on the special effects for you, right? It's not that thousands of people would have had to keep the secret, but there are these things called oaths. And either you're in a secret society or you're in a military organization or you're compartmentalized with your information and you never know enough for the big picture and you get paid so well and they have such control over your life that you never have an incentive really to ask any of those questions.
I put this peg into this hole and I send it down the conveyor belt and where it goes, I don't care because they pay me very well.
Well, it's like the worst things in the world don't happen because of evil people. They happen because other people are apathetic enough to sit by and watch all this evil be perpetrated. And it's done through propaganda, whether it's the Soviets in World War II, the United States propaganda in World War II. I mean, Bernays and Lippmann and the Tavistock Institute created propaganda, and you know, not created it, but effectively used it, institutionalized it such that you are bathing in their propaganda daily. If you recognize, let's say, the different steps of propaganda, like the bandwagon technique and these, you know, the folksy routine and whatnot, you would be able to have a little alarm in your head that goes off every time politics or, you know, these politicians, the economists, or your news broadcasters start to use propaganda to get you to on their position, right? And you will say, oh, I get that. They're trying to use this technique and I'm not taking them seriously now. It's the same thing. It's like if you go to New York for the first time and you see the shell game being played and you see people winning money and you think you're going to play, you know, play the shell game and win some money, you obviously do not know how that shell game works. Because if you knew how it worked, you would cease to be entertained. Entertainment means distraction, right? So don't be distracted by what they're doing. Don't be distracted by the magic wand. I'm telling you, as somebody who worked on the backstage crew helping these guys get their software, until I found out what they were doing in front of the stage, like, it was all cool. I'm like, I'm just selling software. Nobody's getting killed from selling software. I had friends that sold pharmaceuticals. I'm like, yeah, you're probably killing people with that stuff. Software is totally, you know, it's cool. I'm making money the clean way. Little did I know, right, that one day you meet those people and it's like, look, this is the way it is because this is survival of the fittest. This is how it's always been, and you should give into it. You should take the money. You should shut up. I mean, in the past, it wasn't more than a year ago that we had somebody approach us and offer $3 million cash. We could pick it up the next day. Do you want this? And my question was, what can't I say once I get this? He's like, you can't say any of the stuff you said tonight. He said all that stuff that, you know, you guys, we went to the premiere of Paul Verge's Hijacking Humanity in Vancouver. And he said all that stuff that Carlin was saying tonight, that upsets people. You can't have that out there. You can't be telling them that they have owners. He's like, that's the fact. He's like, fraternal societies, we control everything, yes. And so basically it's like there's this fraternal society that's tied to P2 and they're offering this money. And it's like, you can say yes or no. I said no, I'm still here.
That reminds me of a story that the late Aaron Russo said, that he had become friends with a guy named Nicholas Rockefeller, and that would always essentially say to him, like, man, why do you worry about, you know, helping people? Or these, you know, either they're too stupid.
I get that. Yeah.
They don't want your help.
Right? Yeah. It's like Nicholas Rockefeller, because he sees those other people that aren't him or not in his group or don't read his book that he reads that he thinks is God or whatever. Like, they dehumanize. And once they can dehumanize it, they say it doesn't matter about those people. They're doing it to themselves. It's their negative attitude. They could only, if they only would embrace positive thinking, everything would change. Now, positive thinking alone is not going to do it. Positive thinking plus knowing the lay of the land, having an accurate map, something that's reflective of the terrain. Oh, yeah, you can get someplace then. And they don't want you to have that. They don't want you to have a coherent idea of what's going on. They don't want you to know who your owners are. That's why they put a government there. So you can't get to them with a guillotine, right? They're like, oh, as soon as they get to the president, then they know to change things up. The people are onto us. We better put in a different president, you know? But right leg or left leg, Republican or Democrat, it's the same body, and they are progressing straight toward their goal for the past 100 years. They wrote it down, and we have not really knocked them so much as a foot off of their mark yet. However, by getting people organized and getting people in front of other, you know, microphones and cameras and talking intelligently about these things, such that the goal is not to talk amongst ourselves, but to empower each other with the tools and the instruments such that we can communicate what's going on in this country to other people who have the resources and ability to do it, right? We have all the will and the information in the world, but we need people to step up who have the money and the resources to get this information out to more people, right? I'm not looking to get paid and be a millionaire off of this, and neither are you, but we can't do it like eating one meal a day and, like, you know, all the other things that have had to go on to get cameras and to buy microphones and to pay for servers and to build websites. You know, we have been doing this all single threaded, not just me and you. There's also James Corbett. There's also Maria. There's also Jack Blood. There's David Icke. There's all sorts of people out there trying to research, but then there's people out there who want to say, oh, all that guy's good for is he talks about lizards. Well, did you learn about the 300 other things he talks about that are actually valid? And yeah, maybe he had some experience that, you know, whatever. We can't judge him on that. We can only take people for the best facts and information they're willing to purvey to us and put out there and use it for the best of our abilities, right? So it's like, I don't have to like every word in the book to draw some useful information out of there. And I'm certainly smart enough at this point not to judge books by their covers, right?
That's exactly right, and it reminds me also of the late William Cooper. It's easy sometimes to dismiss his work and his research because he talked about aliens.
Well, from my perspective, it's like, look, I do not know if there are aliens or if they're not. I haven't spent a lot of time. However, the things that I have seen are put out by various secret societies to misdirect you away from what's actually going on. There is no supernatural explanation needed to explain the human behavior and the social engineering that's been going on. I can show you logical, reasonable, factual data on how this is all going on. So we don't need to include little space people who make us feel like we can't do anything about our own history or our own future. We can do it. You are the most important person in your life. You know about yourself better than anybody else. You know what's best for you. And what's best for you is probably not looking out to the, you know, someone else from another planet going to help us or hurt us. Let's just look at what's going on here. Let's look at who we call our leaders, why we let them lead us, how we got convinced to let them lead us in the first place, and why we have people that we follow anyway blindly. Shouldn't the people in government, aren't they there working for us, representing our interests? I don't know the last time that anyone's senator or congressman was like, you know, hey, what do you guys think we should be doing in this situation? Obviously, they think once they get in there is whoever's got the biggest check in the checkbook. Hey, yeah, I got your position right now. Page me on the Senate floor. Just let me know which way to vote. Did the check clear or not? That is literally how it works. Cause I've been there with congressmen and senators, you know, because I had friends that worked in their offices and stuff when I lived down in D.C. and Virginia. Everyone down there is working an $18,000 a year job in one of these places, taking their you know, calls from a banker or a lobbyist and telling them what to do in our government. So we have no more direct communication with our senators and congressmen and supposedly elected leaders. So I say, let's start with a clean slate. Let's have this next election be all sorts of people, all sorts of 9/11 truthers and activists and artists and filmmakers who say, look, I have a better idea what's going on because I've been doing the homework, and I'm going to go out there and just, you know, it's not about getting elected. It's about making these other scoundrels improve their game, you know, because the way it's going, it's like if they want to rule the world and they want to do all this stuff, that's cool. You guys been doing it for 5,000 years. Awesome. Really proud of you. Not very creative, but you guys are consistent, right? So here's my point. You guys did it. I didn't know about it for a long time. So clean up your game so I don't have to know about it ever again. So you guys go into the background and visibly control everything to your fucking heart's content, right? But when I have to spend so much of my time looking at the idiotic shit that they purvey out there, asking people to believe it, and then seeing all these people being dumbed down and wasting their human existence and the preciousness of their life being consumed by Britney Spears and Michael Jackson and all this other stuff that they're putting on to misdirect you, right? And if you look into what Michael Jackson said about the New World Order and all these other things that supposedly don't exist, Sony's, you know, Standard Oil of New York, you'll see why he's dead and there's a bunch of people making money off his records today. He was killed. It was a homicide through pharmaceuticals, which currently isn't that illegal. So it's an easy way to pop out somebody who's about to go on tour and influence millions or hundreds of millions of people with love and humility and, you know, a sense of expressing yourself creatively and changing the world, because you're never going to get world peace until you find peace in yourself and you're willing to hate no one. And that's what these people don't want. They want you to pick up arms. They want violence. They want hate. They know exactly how to make money from that. But they do not know how to make money from peace. They do not know how to make money from hemp or a hemp economy and saving our planet and ourselves at the same time. All the facts are out there. We put them in the first edition of Tragedy and Hope, but there's 180 pages in there. You've got articles, audio, video, everything on the energy solution, the financial solution, the health scare situation. And we show you not only the tragedy, we not only show you what's going on, but we show you the hope. We give you the solutions. It's the only magazine in the world focused on giving you the solutions to the biggest problems that face mankind. So it's not, you know, it's not something I ever have to try to go and sell. I just have to let people know it's there and what it is and what it holds, and they kind of do the rest. Because it's logical. It's a logical extension of the internet because it organizes data, and without organized data, knowledge is not power until it's organized and directed at a definite end. That's what Tragedy and Hope is. It's a practical application of everything we've talked about in this whole show. It is a way that is there to empower yourself, other people who are producing content and media, other people who want to get involved and just want to do something small every month that adds up to the whole world of difference that you're in part experiencing within the confines of this audio interview.
I think that that is probably the best way to cap this off. And I think it all kind of culminated with the reality that these people, yeah, like you said, they aren't necessarily sinister, evil creature monsters. They're people with names and addresses, and a lot of what they've done has a paper trail. And the other solution, too, is that We can see that. We can more or less just say no. And there are solutions. So just as, you know, these guys, you know, have names and addresses, the problems have solutions, ultimately. And again, the media has pretty much always told us that you have no power, you have no control, people smarter than you have it all figured out, so just don't worry your pretty little head about it. But if there are those two things that we hit, I feel like ending corporate personhood and growing hemp is really kind of gets at the heart of really, I think, what we could do with real changes.
Well, I'll even take it one step further. I would just make this simple observation. It's a quote from a guy named Daniel Boorstin, who used to be a Librarian of Congress, and he's also a Rhodes Scholar. So Cecil Rhodes, in his will, is sending this quote to you, and it can set you free. Because here's what it says. It says, "The greatest obstacle to discovery is not ignorance. It's the illusion of knowledge." So stop thinking that you know something without having done it, right? Belief in ideology, the doing of things that we don't know what they mean, but we do them anyway, right? If you replace what you think you believe and see that belief is a placeholder, it's an invitation for you to fill in this area with some real experience, with some learning, some doing on your own. Do not rely on your beliefs. Your beliefs are a blind spot that you have not investigated yet. And do not put any faith on anything that has been given to you by another human being who was here years ago and created some status quo that you're inheriting, because other men have kept it alive to control you through your mind.
Unless there is... I don't think so. I think that is probably the summation of this. But I'll give you the opportunity. Is there anything else that you want to put out? Any, you know, tragedyandhope.com is the current focal point. Is the project?
Tragedyandhope.com is the world's first online multimedia magazine made specifically to empower you with the information that corporations can't afford to give you, literally can't afford to give you, because if they gave it to you, they would lose their advertisers, they would lose their power in your lives, because they haven't figured out a way yet to make money from being truthful. So tragedyandhope.com, you can subscribe for a free 2-week trial. Go ahead and sign up, get into the Tragedy and Hope community, start to experience the fear-free area and the resources and the tools that we give you. And put at your disposal. There's also the brain with 3,500 different items connected up, so it can help expedite anyone's journey through all this, you know, this myriad and multitude of information that we have to take in to find out where we are. There's a bunch of friendly people in there who have been patiently waiting along with our lengthy pieces of media over the past several years, and you know, it's unlike any other place out there, and it was created specifically for you if you're interested.
Richard Grove, thank you so much for appearing on Media Monarchy. And again, this was sort of a pivotal time. This was, I believe, the time to do it. We're here at the 8th anniversary of something that had ripples effect and affects both ourselves and everyone else in the world. And we're just here trying to disseminate the information. So again, I really appreciate you taking the time to do this. It means a lot to me.
Hey, James, it means a lot to me. And I want to thank you and your audience for, you know, just doing what you guys do out there. I mean, showing up every week to download a podcast is not hard work, but finding the time to break your habits, put it into your schedule, to listen to it, to take some notes, and to take something positive from it is, you know, that's half the battle. The other half is just showing up. So turn off your TV, go to the library, leverage your Netflix subscription, get the Medici disc. There's like a 3 or 4 disc set. Learn all about this stuff. Stop watching Hollywood productions, cancel your magazine subscriptions, and vote with your fork. That's all I got.
All right, brother. Ladies and gentlemen, you've been listening to an interview with Richard Andrew Grove of tragedyandhope.com. I really appreciate all you guys who are out there listening to this broadcast. My name's James Evan Pilato. I'm the host and webmaster of the site and show MediaMonarchy.com, coming to you from September 10th, 2009 in Portland, Oregon. I want to again thank my guest, Richard Grove, and thank you guys for listening.
Hey, just so you know, it's now September 11th here, so we actually got all the way into the day, and we've started off the day right with a little healthy, nutritious activism. Thanks so much, James.
Absolutely, brother. Thank you. Take care.
And that's a wrap. That's a wrap. There we go.
Sweet.
Did you get everything you wanted?
Oh, man. Absolutely. There's, you know, and that's, as you know, there are times, and this is probably just the... eighth interview that I think I've done as a little standalone interview episode.
It's very difficult. It's an acquired skill, and I think you did an awesome job. The last thing I had on my list here is...
Welcome to Tragedy and Hope, the first service of its kind and the most useful magazine on the planet, strategically designed with you in mind. My name's Richard Grove, and I'm the editor of Tragedy and Hope magazine, and we, on this side of the screen, are honored by your presence and your attention on your side of the screen, as this entire project was created to empower you. If you find yourself here, let's click on the Tragedy and Hope magazine link, which brings you here to the tragedyandhope.com homepage. And now, since we're all on the same page, and that's my job, it's my pleasure to introduce Lisa Arborcheski, publisher of Tragedy and Hope. Together, we'll navigate you through what we've built with the help of a few of our friends, and she's going to help me shed some light on this project so you can see for yourself.
Welcome. Tragedy and Hope is a solution-based internet subscription service which researches, organizes, presents, and delivers relevant information in historical and contemporary context. By bringing together a dream team of artists and media creators, we provide you with a multitude of perspectives to empower you with the organized knowledge you need to confidently weigh and make informed decisions on your own behalf. Subscribers to Tragedy and Hope are people who are conscious and aware of the world around them and looking to elevate their level of critical thinking through learning and growing. Subscribers enjoy a number of resources, and since we're funded solely by our subscribing audience, we have no motivation or reward to censor or suppress information, and we're not going to use fear to try and sell you anything.
What you see herein is a practical application of everything we've learned during the 4 years it's taken to create this solution. The problem we've solved is this. Corporate media's extreme profits are driven by advertiser dollars. And when that advertiser's products are toxic, and that advertiser's profiting from externalizing the true costs of their actions to you, then you're left unwittingly funding their profits with your life.
Tragedy and Hope was designed to circumvent the tragic flaw of the publicly traded corporation, whereby you, our subscribers, take the place of advertisers in the funding of the publication. Therefore, it's in our best interest to serve your best interests. And that is what we mean by Tragedy and Hope being our common ground.
The homepage is meant to be simple and straightforward, and anytime you find yourself realizing the value of the services we provide, you can click right here to get started. Now, if you're less sure, there's also a free trial register button up here at the top. So let's just do that and register. See that? Clean, simple, no hassles, and you're in. Now you can see that the menu's expanded to show additional tabs. So let's start clicking on the tab marked The Magazine.
TragedyandHope.com hosts the world's first online flip-page multimedia magazine created to empower you, sharing the text, audio, video, and links necessary to become organized and informed above the mainstream.
I like to go ahead and make it full screen by clicking right here, and then go over here to choose a background. Click here. There's the park, the beach, and the office. Let's go to the park. That's perfect. Starting from the left, you can make the magazine regular size. You can fit it to the page. You can zoom in, zoom out, full screen, of course. There's also a low quality version for subscribers with low bandwidth requirements or dial-up. And there's also a button to turn the background sound on and off, which is quite convenient. We created this prototype issue to illustrate the various areas in which we realize corporate media cannot meet the needs of our audience. They literally can't afford to show you this stuff. So this premiere issue represents the ideas divided into 16 categories, each with two topics, demonstrating the various ways that we can sidestep the panic of our own world and work directly on realistic, healthy, and sustainable solutions. You can turn the page by grabbing the corner like this, or you can use these buttons to conveniently navigate by clicking. The first 30 pages or so were written to memorialize the ideas upon which we were inspired to create the full 180 pages of our demo magazine. So let me give you a quick tour of how the features work. Tragedy and Hope is the first magazine to be able to offer you audio, video, and text as a way to elevate your perspectives beyond what mainstream media can afford to offer you. To play the video, you click here, and then here to play, click here to pause, and you can click here for full screen. And we've made it so you can listen to the video while you flip pages, or you can turn it off as you continue exploring. Going back to the main site, let's click on a tab which reads Tragedy and Hope TV, or TNH TV.
Tragedy and Hope TV is our own private version of YouTube without the restrictions.
It's where our subscribers can upload audio interviews and video clips which are not found on YouTube or have been censored from YouTube. We've set a 2 GB limit on videos, and we can extend these in the case that a subscriber needs it. We can make our own rules. So this is a valuable and strategic resource for subscribers to share videos and audio interviews. The next tab over is what we call the brain.
No other media organization offers a research map, let alone a model which is as comprehensive and extensive as this.
This is probably the most valuable resource to our subscribers, if not the most useful, outside of the magazine. Now, when Tim Berners-Lee created the World Wide Web, it was a godsend to be able to link data all over the world and give people access. But it was really only for nerds because it was hard to use. When Mark Andreessen launched Netscape to surf the internet, it was a blessing which we would eventually all learn to love and use in various future forms. Today, we've employed a technology which links data into a browser. What I've built here is a prototype model containing about 3,500 people and events throughout history, providing a unique perspective, a window, if you will, of interconnectivity of our existence as human beings and history itself. Pretty much anything anyone needs to know about either is or will be in this model, at least as far as politics, economics, religion, philosophy, mathematics, history, and other major areas of history go. The thinking behind it was, if you're on the internet, and it's a safe bet that you are, then you're probably looking for information, which is literally everywhere. The internet's a really great start, but it's not the best at sourcing and organizing the information you really need. Tragedy and Hope is the logical extension of the internet, whereby our service organizes and presents information in a meaningful context, and thus, you're able to make more informed decisions and increase your social, physical, and intellectual wealth. Information's only power when it's organized, and Tragedy and Hope organizes useful information to help you find the answers to your biggest questions, to solve your greatest challenges. It's not valuable. It's necessary and invaluable because it can help you survive. The next tab over is the Tragedy and Hope community, bringing us full circle to explore the tragedy and the hope through our social network community, which you can access by simply clicking here.
The Tragedy and Hope community is a place where people can interact and engage in intellectual discussions, sort of like a virtual water cooler, where people can gather and share information in a space which inspires critical thought and respectful debate. This provides a fear-free environment for our subscribers to come together to explore and discover the solutions that exist and require our conscious, constructive participation in order to be realized.
This is where our subscribers, guests participating at the invitation of subscribers, and our affiliate partners share daily news, events, videos, audio interviews, books, blogs, groups, forum conversations, chat discussions, and just about any and every type of electronic media communication, giving our subscribers the cutting-edge tools we all need to learn and grow beyond the challenges we face together as a group. Here in the Tragedy and Hope Think Tank, we're discussing solutions which already exist, and how to get this information into your hands so we can unite and create constructive change which reflects a sustainable and independent lifestyle. And that wraps it up for the quick tour of the benefits of subscribing. This is the first in a series of Tragedy and Hope how-to videos created to help our subscribing audience get the most for the least, and learning that working together on common ground to progress our understanding of the world is an invaluable activity that we're all proud of sharing as we grow as individuals. Before we can solve our problems, we must first outgrow them. Tragedy and Hope, your life in balance because you're subscribed to a higher awareness.
Thanks so much for your time and attention. Tragedy and Hope is the only media network with a brain and a heart because we're powered by you, not corporate interests.
we can realize happiness, not just pursue it.